بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أدى الرسالة وبلغ الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده، وتركنا صلى الله عليه وسلم على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك ولا يتنكبها إلا ضال. ثم أما بعد، يا أيها الذين أمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. يا أيها الذين أمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين. My dear brothers, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today inshallah the talk will be regarding the Khawarij. The talk might be long, so if you want to relax or lean back to the wall, there is no problem, because most important that don't leave your mind to sleep. The Khawarij is a term which introduced by scholars of Islam for people who have a certain category, a certain belief, a certain deviation from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. But we shall never underestimate the danger of Khawarij. We will talk about the Khawarij first. But unfortunately, there is many people now, they are more dangerous than the Khawarij, who are using the term of Khawarij to scare people from enjoying the good and also forbidding the evil. The Khawarij, they could be a cancer for the Ummah, to eat the Ummah from inside, cause enmity inside the Ummah, spill the blood of the Ummah. Yes, indeed. But other people, they're using that term badly, so that somebody from outside the Ummah could do even worse than that. From outside the nation could be worse than that. The Khawarij, they have a story. They have a prediction from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam predicted them before they even come. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against them before they even come, as he did warn against people who will do worse than them as well. So Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah should not be afraid to deliver the truth, for as long as they comply with the Sharia, for as long as they are servants for the Sharia, for as long as they serve the Sharia according to the conditions of the Sharia, not according to the desire, according to their whims. So what are the Khawarij really? What is the definition of the Khawarij? What is Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah definition for the Khawarij? Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah definition for the Khawarij is for anybody who goes out of Islam, calling Muslims non-Muslims because of their sins and because of their mistakes, or because of what he thinks it's a mistake or a sin. So this is the most important feature about Khawarij. The second feature about Khawarij, or the second most important thing about Khawarij, that he is willing to spill the blood of the Ummah, the blood of Muslims, because of this kind of thought, because of his definition of right and wrong. And also, he is not willing to fight Jews, Christians, or anybody else before he finish from the Ummah, or before he finishes from what he thinks it's a cancer in the Ummah. Alaykum as-salam. And he could be one of the cancer of the Ummah. The third feature about the Khawarij, that he goes against a legitimate ruler, a ruler which is accepted by Ahlul Hal wal Aqd. Who is Ahlul Hal wal Aqd? Are the people who have the authority to employ a Khalifa or to endorse a Khalifa. So these are the main three features of the Khawarij. So when we get that term, we should understand that the three main features of the Khawarij is just that. Calling people kafirs because of sins less than kufr, spilling the blood of Muslims and leaving the kafirs. Watch that, spilling the blood of Muslims and leaves the kafirs. And thirdly, going against a legitimate ruler, try to topple him or actually go against him. So these are the features which is the scholars of Islam unanimously did talk about Khawarij. Unfortunately, the evil scholars and the people who are working just for the benefit of the ruler other than the benefit of Islam, they left the first two categories, which is that they call people non-Muslims because of sins, and they kill Muslims and they leave non-Muslims, or they fight Muslims and they leave out non-Muslims. And they took only the third category of the Khawarij, that they go against the legitimate ruler. So anybody goes against a legitimate ruler in their side, he is a Khawarij. Obviously, we will explain how did they contradict themselves and how did they have gone against Islam completely. But the situation we have in now, as we're going to explain, there is no legitimate ruler now ruling Islam. They are all cowboys, Alibaba and the 40 thieves, if they are not out of Islam. So there is no legitimate rulers. They did not come through Ahlul Hal wal Aqd. They came imposed by the imperialism and by the communists who've been ruling our countries. When they depart themselves physically, they gone and they left the knife. They left their knives in the hands of our tyrants now. So the order, and we are in the slaughterhouse of the East and the West, using their knives in the hands of somebody called Ahmad or Muhammad or Imran Khan or Khanazir Bhutto or whatever. Hosni Mubarak or whatever. We still slaughtered by the knives of these people. So the first thing they do is they call these rulers legitimate rulers, and the second they do, using the term Khawarij, that they call anybody enjoying the good and forbid the evil, are telling this is not right, this is haram, this is not Islam, here is a Khawarij. Because the people do love Islam. Average Muslim loves Islam. Average Muslim wants to go to paradise. A little bit knowledgeable Muslim, he knows the warning and the threats from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam against the Khawarij. So once one scholar is using that term for the benefit of his ruler, every Muslim will shake to his boots. Why should I be Khawarij? Why should I do this? I will mind my own business. The result of that, my dear brothers, that there is no enjoying the good and forbid the evil in the Muslim society anymore. The accumulation of this silence with the activities of kafirs and the activities of munafiqs have resulted that the ummah has been fragmented, have resulted that the khilafah has gone, have resulted that we only have in our countries traitors to rule and traitors of scholars to help them. And the result of that, the loss of Jerusalem, the loss of Mecca. Mecca is always under the threat now. The loss of Medina and the loss of any secure Muslim land, plus our wealth, is departed automatically to the banks of the West. And our brothers are all behind bars, the sincere ones. The rest are afraid to talk. All this because whenever anybody say this is not allowed, this is not Islam, they call him, they point the Kalashnikov of Khawarij against his chest. Oh, you are Khawarij, you want to insult our ruler, you want, even if he tells them words which Umar ibn al-Khattab would listen to and would class it as a good thing, like what Salman and Safar al-Hawari and most of the scholars used to say as just advice for the rulers, and they end up in prison, and they end up humiliated, and they end up sometimes called Khawarij. Their tapes were being taken from everywhere. However, let us see the term Khawarij. How did Rasulullah ﷺ predict it? And what was the story of Khawarij before we start giving our definitions, or even the scholars of Ahl-Sunnah Jama'ah's definitions? And as we talk, just to have idea about the kind of rulers we have, I will just, as we talk, just go with these pictures, see it, show it to the brothers. This is a picture of, show it in the front of the camera as well as you go. Picture of say, if there is anybody Muslim in our rulers, there is pictures underneath with the King Kong Fahd dancing amongst the whores with Johnny Walker's, with alcohol and around himself. Just show the pictures. There's some pictures underneath as well. There's some pictures underneath. Yeah, just to see what kind of rulers they are. He is supposed to be the king of the holy place, Mecca, where when he gets his kingdom, the Evening Standard have said the most important customer for the Playboy have been the king of the most holy place in the whole world. Obviously, Hosni Mubarak is much worse than him. Also, so if this is the so-called Khalifa now dancing among his whores and with the wine and with the whiskey in his hand, wearing the cross as well. You seen him wearing the cross, right? So if these are the kind of rulers we have, then obviously nobody have the right to say they are legitimate rulers when they are endorsing kufr and they prove their kufr loudly, unapologetic, unrepentant, continuously from bad to worse. So these are the kind of rulers we have now. However, what is the story about the Khawarij? The story starts from the prediction of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He sent Ali ibn Abi Talib to Yemen to collect some Islamic zakat, and then Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he sent him back some gold. When gold came, he, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he split the gold amongst peoples, rich people, because he want to make their heart lenient toward Islam. They were newcomers to Islam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he split the gold amongst them four people, Al-Aqra ibn Habis and many and another three. So the Muslims, the Muhajireen, the poor Muhajireen, and also the Al-Ansar, the helpers, they said, oh, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave this to rich people. Some of the Muhajireen and Ansar said that. Also, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he won't by the strength of Islam of these people, that their people will follow them, because they are leaders in their communities. And this is what he called in Islam, al-mu'allafatu qulubuhum, that the people whom you try to buy their hearts first, so they can enjoy enjoy Islam, and later they will spend in Islam. This is what was the policy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Muhajireen and the Ansar, they were very polite, and always they have with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said nothing. They said that amongst themselves, but they didn't say anything loud. A person came, his head was shaved, and his forehead, his description that his forehead was a bit out, and he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with big beard. He said, oh Muhammad, be just. This is not just. I'm trying to summarize you the hadith, which is in Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim and Imam Abu Dawud and Imam Tirmizi, and there is about no less than 40 hadith with regard to the Khawarij. All of them give some descriptions of the Khawarij. However, he said, oh Muhammad, be just. Then Rasulullah he said, subhanallah, if I am not just, who will be just? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, trust me with his message. I am entrusted by all the angels, by heaven and earth and everything, for the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So who will be just if I'm not just? Then Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu, he said, let me kill this man, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, maybe he's still praying. And he said, how many people, Khalid ibn Walid, he said, how many people they pray and they have inside their hearts non-Islamic things? Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, I was not asked to search in people's hearts. Every word of this hadith is very important. It give us a whole policy to learn and to be strict. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the man turned away and he walked. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had a look at his back when he was going. He said, يَخْرُجُ مِنْ ضُؤْدِ هَذَا الرَّجُلِ, it will come out of the backside of this person, people, certain kind of people, they will read Quran nicely, but it will not exceed their throat. Walaykum as-salam wa barakatuh. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again, they will kill Muslims and they leave alone non-Muslims. See, they will kill Muslims and they will leave alone non-Muslims. This is the main descriptions. He said they will go out of Islam as the arrow goes out of the prey. You know, when you catch a prey, you just shoot an arrow for it, and the prey, and the arrow goes from this side to the other side because it's very fast. You can't even chase any blood in the arrow. يخرجون من الإسلام كما يخرج السهم من الرمية. Very fast arrow goes into the prey, goes from the other side, you can't even chase. How? Did it pass through it or not? Because of the out of Islam, very fast and very determined. No east, no west. Out of Islam. Then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, if I catch up with them, I will kill them the kill of Ad. You know the Ad? Which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have sent for them the wind for 8 nights and 7 days continuously until they became rotten. In the other hadith he said, I will kill them the kill of Thamud. Thamud are the people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send them the she camel and to drink from the water, and then they slaughter it. And you see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have said. It means I will leave nobody from them. I will kill them in a very bad way. I'll even massacre them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the other hadith, which is Abu Umam al-Bahili narrated on the authority of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, when he seen the heads of the Khawarij in Damascus, that was the second generation of Khawarij, as we will explain, inshallah. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whenever one generation goes from Khawarij, another generation will come from Khawarij. And he called it a horn of Khawarij. So the second generation of Khawarij, Abu Umama radiallahu anhu, one of the Sahaba, when he saw them in Damascus, he was crying. He said, what he said about them? He said, the worst people to be murdered under heaven are these people. شر قتلى تحت أديم السماء. He said, the best person will be killed by them. The best person will be murdered. He will be murdered by them. And then they said, why you are crying? He said, because they used to be a believers. They used to be a believers before. This hadith is narrated by Imam Abu Dawood and also narrated by Imam Tirmizi in the tafsir of the ayah in Al Imran, يَوْمَ تَبِيَضُّ وُجُوهٌ وَتَسْوَدُّ وُجُوهٌ فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ اسْوَدَّتْ وُجُوهُهُمْ أَكَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ فَذُوقُوا الْعَذَابَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَكْفُرُونَ وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ ابْيَضَّتْ وُجُوهُهُمْ فَفِي رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. The verse from Al Imran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, on the day where some faces will be white, others will be blackened, and those whose faces being blacked, they will be called, did you turn again the Muslims after your Islam? Did you become a kafir after your Islam? So those are the Khawarij. According to the majority of the scholars, Khawarij are not kafirs. They are bid'ah people, except one branch of Khawarij whom they denied the surah of Yusuf alayhi salam. They said this is a love story, it's not a surah. You know the surah of Yusuf? And these are the Khawarij who are kafirs actually, because of the denial to the Quran. However, Abu Umam al-Bahili, when he cried, said, why you cried? He said, because they've been Muslims and they turned again non-Muslim because of their crime. One other hadith, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu narrated with regard to the Khawarij. He said, in the authority of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if the people who fight them, they know what have been written in the reward by just fighting these people, they wouldn't have done much in Islam anymore. لَنَكَلُوا عَنِ الْعَمَلِ. They would be relaying just in their good action by fighting this Khawarij. So these are hadiths to encourage people to fight the Khawarij. But who are the Khawarij? The same definitions which Rasulullah ﷺ have said. They kill Muslims. What did Rasulullah ﷺ, when he defined the Khawarij in hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, what did he say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said they kill the people of Islam and they leave alone the people of non-Muslims, the idol worshippers. So the first category, when you look for somebody is Khawarij or not, look for that. Who is killing the people of Islam? And who is living alone? The non-Muslim people. That was the prediction and the summarize of the summary of the hadith of how many hadith of the Khawarij from Imam Bukhari, from Imam Muslim, from Abu Dawood, from Tirmizi, and from many other people. So we summarize that, and there is no dispute about this hadith, or the meaning of this hadith is very clear. Now let us start with what is the actual, how they actually begin. This, that was the prophecy of Rasulullah ﷺ predicting for them that they come from the back of this person. But when they actually, when they have actually started, the Khawarij have actually started from the time of Osman. They started in their heart. They started by a call of somebody called Abdullah ibn Sabah, the founder of the Shia people. But he did not provoke them. He used the message, as we will talk inshallah, we will talk again about the Shia in some other time. Abdullah ibn Sabah, he wanted to destruct Islam from the inside, because he was a Jew from Yemen. His mother, he's Jew from Yemen, he's called Ibn Sauda. Then he wanted to destruct Islam from the inside. He couldn't. He tried at Kufa, he failed. He tried at Basra, he failed. He tried at Mecca, he failed. He tried at Medina, he failed. Then he goes to Egypt. He went to Egypt, he started praying and crying. The people of Egypt were strict about him. And then he got some followers. He said, we must enjoin the good and forbid the evil. And they start sending letters to each other. People from Egypt send the letters to the people of Basra, tell them, what are your rulers are doing? Our rulers are doing this, our rulers are doing that. What is the mistakes they're doing? What is the wrongdoing they're doing? He tried basically to make Ali ibn Abi Talib and the people of Ahlul Bayt to give them superiority against anybody else so he can destruct Islam from this point of view. But while he was doing this, these papers which is going around around the people about what the rulers are doing, it provoked somebody else against the rulers. Some people who were really worshippers, some people who were really good in Quran and good in this, but their minds were revolutionary. Without getting important knowledge about the deen. So they start seeing what the rulers are doing. So they shared in the killing of Uthman. Obviously there was some plot against Uthman radiallahu anhu when people have falsified some papers, and even in the killing of Uthman, the son of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, have shared in the killing of Uthman. Many of the people have been misled and they've shared in the killing of Uthman. The Khawarij, some of them have shared also in the killing of Uthman. But that was mainly a plot. We will talk more explicitly with regard to the Shia. The resentment against anybody does a mistake in their sight, that was the start of the Khawarij. Then that provokes more and more when the battle of Al-Jamal, the battle of the camel, which was between Ali radiallahu anhu and some of the Sahaba, and it was against Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiallahu anha with regard to unify the Ummah and to go and fight Muawiyah radiallahu anhu because he did not give bay'ah to Ali. Amongst all these, the Khawarij was there. But they did not know that they are Khawarij and they did not intend that they are Khawarij, but the idea was developing and inside their hearts that anybody does a mistake, he should be punished harshly. And then that develops and develops and develops. The roots started from there. Resentment against what they dislike. Resentment against what they dislike. However, in the second battle, you know, the first battle of the camel, which the Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha, the camel was there was about 10,000 people killed in this battle from amongst the Sahaba, 5,000 from the side of Aisha radiallahu anhu, and 5,000 from the side of Ali radiallahu anhu. And then Ali won the battle, and Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiallahu anha, she was sent back to Medina with guards. However, Ali radiallahu anhu, he collected the people from Kufa and collected the people from Iraq. With him was the people who were the founders of Khawarij. But still until now they have the resentment, but they did not speak it out and they did not have a meeting about it. They were not like the group of Abdullah ibn Sabah al-Khabith who was grouping and he was using the people who have killed the Uthman to divide the Ummah from the inside. He was not planning for the Khawarij. He was planning to make enmity between Ahlul Bayt, the people of Rasulullah ﷺ, the family, and the rest of the Sahaba. But the Khawarij was using his papers and his propagation against the rulers to have some other idea, Islamic idea, or un-Islamic idea. Using their idea, they think it's Islamic, against a legitimate rulers and something which it could be called a sin or it could be called a mistake in their sight. It could be probably not be called even a mistake. However, he took them, radiallahu anhu, Imam Ali, to fight Muawiyah. Imam Ali, when Muawiyah refused to give him bay'ah, he did not call him Khawarij. Imam Ali, when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu collected many people to ask for the blood of Uthman, he did not call anybody who followed Muawiyah Khawarij. He did not tell him, I am the legitimate Imam and you go out of me and you are Khawarij, I'm going to kill you. No, he didn't say that. And that, he did not call him a kafir. And that many people of the followers of Ali, they used to dislike. How come he did not call Muawiyah a kafir? How come? Then Muawiyah start fighting with Ali, start cursing Ali on the members. Start cursing Ali of the members. Just put it off. However, that was not actually approved by Imam Ali, but yet they asked him, why don't you curse Muawiyah also as he cursed you? He said, no, we don't do that. Who has the right to curse? As I'm giving you the story, think. Who has the right to curse who? The one who go out of a Khalifa, a legitimate Khalifa, a Khalifa who is related to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is he the one who have the right to curse if there's any curse should be, or the one who's gone out of his way? Who has the right to curse? Ali ibn Abi Talib or Muawiyah? But although Ali is more to that because, but he did not do it. Why? He been asked. What are they then? He said, they are our brothers. But they are undoing us. إخواننا بغوا علينا. They are just undoing us. They think they are doing good, but they are just undoing us. As we will explain. You maybe think, oh, he was right all the way, Imam Ali, and they are wrong. Yes, but if you study the Shia, how they start, you will know if you are in this time, Alhamdulillah, we are not in this time, that you wouldn't know what to do. Because there is so many enemies who cause enmity amongst from both sides. However, he did not call Muawiyah Khawarij. Then the fight started. He called him, repent to Allah, give me bay'ah, otherwise I will fight you. Then they refused. On the side of Muawiyah, who was who? It was Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhu. Very clever person, Amr ibn al-As. Very, very clever person. Sometimes they call him the fox of Islam. The fight starts, and the people of Imam Ali, they have done their work, they have done their best. And Muawiyah, with his people from Sham, from Syria, and from Lebanon, all these people, they were really defeated in this war. And it was shown clearly that they were defeated. And it's only a couple of hours until everything finished. Then Amr ibn al-As, he said, shall I suggest for you something, Muawiyah, which you will make us stronger and bitter, and it will make their party divided as ever. He said, what? He said, you're going to lose the war anyway. Why don't you raise the Quran on the top of the spears? And he say, let us judge the Quran amongst us. Why we kill each other? Why we don't put the Quran? Why we don't judge the Quran amongst us? Here is the book of Allah. Why we kill each other? They did just that. Then some of the people of Ali, he said, look, huh? They want the Quran to be judged amongst us, why we should kill each other? Then Imam Ali said, no, why we are here first place? Why did you not judge the Quran amongst them first place? We did call them. We are the first people to call them for the Quran. Now because they are defeated, they want the Quran, they want to judge the Quran so they can have a breath and they can reorganize themselves. Carry on in your fight, Bismillah, and let us finish this fitna, is nearly finished. He said, no, this is not Islamic. When somebody asks you to come, to rule by Allah, then you must apply the rule by Allah, otherwise you are not a Muslim, you are going to be a kafir. Then this was the first word to be introduced. If you don't, you are a kafir. If you don't, that was the start. The terms now were starting to build up in the heat of the battle. In the heat of the battle. And these people who have been objecting, a lot of them were from the murderers of Uthman alayhi salam. They were not few. They increased the number. They became about 10,000 people. When any time Ali ibn Abi Talib wants to retaliate for the killing of Uthman, they said, we all killed Uthman, 10,000 people. And that was one of the reasons why Muawiyah is fighting Ali. He said, how come I give you bay'ah and the killers of Uthman in your side? And you did not get the blood of Uthman yet. Get them out, kill them, I will give you bay'ah. However, we'll discuss this when we come to the Shia. So these people, they said to Ali, and amongst them was the Khawarij, they said, if you don't apply the Sharia, we will do for you as we did for Uthman. Make no mistake about it. So indeed the fitna happened in the Mu'askar of Ali radiallahu anhu. So he said, this is a mistake. You will regret it later. He said, we don't regret. If somebody asks us to rule by Allah. However, they stopped the fight. They stopped the fight, and Muawiyah was very happy, and Amr ibn As were very happy. They have solidarity, but they were weaker than Imam Ali at the time. However, they did write an agreement to explain how they're going to judge between Muawiyah and Ali. They ask Imam Ali to produce one person from his camp, and Muawiyah will produce one person from his camp. Already Muawiyah have chosen Amr ibn al-As, because he's the one who got the idea from the beginning. He knows how to finish it well, and he knows what was the call for. Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said, I will choose Ibn Abbas, because he's my cousin and he knows the tricks, and he's very clever. They said, Ibn Abbas means yourself. His camp, look, he's been messed about with his camp. The camp of Muawiyah was all one body under the leadership of Muawiyah. The camp of Ali ibn Abi Talib, it was all the way. Since this fitna happened, they've gone everywhere. He said, no, choosing Ibn Abbas, it means it's yourself. He said, you must choose somebody clever, because Amr ibn As is very clever. They said, no, we choose Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. He's a very pious man, and he's a companion of Rasulullah, mature person. He said, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is a very good-hearted person, he will be tricked. They said, no, don't give us this. He said, you will regret that later. Then they said, no, this is what I have chosen. Then he agreed. But then they wrote the paper to say, okay, that these two people will judge between Ali and Uthman, Ali and Muawiyah, and whatever they came as a decision, it must be endorsed for the Ummah, and everybody must listen. While they were writing this paper, some of the Khawarij, they said, how come we allow people? Then the Shaitan came to them. He said, you want to rule, you stopped the war to rule by the Quran. But how come they allowing people to rule? They said Abu Musa al-Ash'ari and Amr ibn al-As, they will rule and they will make a decision and everybody must listen. How come we listen to the decision of people and we are supposed only to listen to the decision of Allah and the Quran? How come we listen to people? This is, we are not judging the Quran, then we are making judgment to people. Very stupid again, because the Quran, we're not going to talk. The Quran, you see, but see how these people, when they are very crude in their minds and they read verses and they wanted to apply verse by verse. However, they said, that is not on. This is not what we agreed about, to make the Quran judge amongst us. Then the person came from Muawiyah, was reading the conditions of how the judgment should be made, and they should meet in one month or 2 months, these two people, to read loudly what they have decided. Then the Khawarij, when he was reading the conditions, they've killed his camel. They slaughtered his camel, and the man drops in the floor, and they said, we said you to judge by the Quran, not to judge by people like me and you and this and that. So Imam Ali said, this is what you have agreed before. I told you not to do it. Now you are divided. And then that was agreed. He said, no, tell them no, let's go and fight him now. He said, it was not on. That was from the beginning. From the beginning I told you not to fight. He said, no, you must go back now and tell him this is not on. We will fight tomorrow. Allahu Akbar. Imam Ali said, no, I must honor what I have said, regardless of what hard time you have given me. And he spent the journey time from Siffin, where was the battlefield, up to Kufa, the camp of Ali, swearing at each other, spitting at each other. This one, he said to them, you have called people to rule amongst them, you are disobedient to Allah. And the other ones, which is the obedient to Imam Ali, they said to them, you have gone against our Imam, you have gone against our Khalifa, and you have put him down by asking for the judgment first, and then going against your word back. They spend all the way traveling, spitting at each other, swearing at each other, throwing each other with shoes and things like that. However, they went to Kufa, and it was now the discussions between Abu Musa al-Ash'ari and Amr ibn al-As was start going on. When they went to Kufa, they said, that's it, we're not going to have it anymore. Ali is not, Muawiyah is a kafir, they said, Muawiyah is a kafir. And what is wanted from Ali now is to call Muawiyah a kafir. And they went out of the Kufa, they've taken their people, they've crossed the river to Nahrawan, and they stayed on the Jisr, which is they stayed near the Jisr, which is near the bridge from Nahrawan. And there is a hadith from Rasulullah that he will be killed near the Jisr there. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, amongst them will be somebody with a little tit on the top of his elbow. Like a tit, a woman. He said like a woman tit, like a woman bosom. And he's got some hair into it. And that person was found killed in the end. However, the judgment was not ready yet. But even though, they said, at this stage Muawiyah is a kafir, and Ali have accepted that people to rule, accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rules, and we will not go into his camp unless he called Muawiyah kafir. Allahu Akbar. And then Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said, I'm not going to fight you, I'm not going to do anything unless you're going to spill the blood of Muslims, then we will not going to stop you from coming to our mosques. Although they used to come to the mosque and make shouting when Ali ibn Abi Talib delivered a khutbah or read, he said, إِنِ الْحُكْمِ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ, judgment is only for Allah. Then Imam Ali used to say to them, this is a word of truth, but what is needed from it is a falsehood. You are saying a word of the truth by saying judgment is only for Allah, but the book of Allah cannot talk by itself, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given judgment to people. However, he sent them Ibn Abbas to talk to them. Then they said to him, well, Ali is not a good leader anyway, and there's two things we want to ask him about it. He said, number one, when we fought the army of Aisha, why he did not distribute the money amongst us? Then Imam Ali came at the time. He said, let me answer them. He said to them, oh, you want the money and the booty from fighting Aisha group. Okay, who of you will have Umm al-Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers, Aisha, in his booty? Who of you can take the mother of Umm al-Mu'mineen as a booty? If anybody accepted that, he's a kafir, to take Umm al-Mu'mineen as a booty. So how come I distribute amongst you the money of our brothers who have been wrongdoing us? They are not kafirs. How come? So they said, and why you accept the judgment of people where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying the judgment is only for Allah? Then he said to them, but Allah said to accept judgment of people. If there is a dispute between a wife and a husband, Allah said subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَبْعَثُوا حَكَمًا مِنْ أَهْلِهِ وَحَكَمًا مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. Then if there is a dispute between a man and his wife, send one judge from her family and one judge from his family to reconciliate amongst them. And this is a bigger matter and much serious matter for the blood of Muslims. Wouldn't I send one from my side and one from his side to reconciliate and preserve the blood of the brothers, the blood of the believers? And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, then يَحْكُمُ بِهِ ذَوَى عَدْلٍ مِنْكُمْ. If somebody kill unlawfully a hunt in Mecca on the time of Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, make two judges to see how much he should pay. It was not said in the Quran. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about these small things, he had that we accept two judges, so why shouldn't I accept? Plus it was your suggestion for first place. However, some of them, they came back, and the rest did not come back. While this scenario was happening, Amr ibn al-As, he said to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he was preparing, continues the trick. It was the first, the tahkim was a trick to start with. So he was continuing the trick. Amr ibn al-As said to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he said, listen, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is a simple-minded man, and he doesn't think anyone from the Sahaba could actually work for such a trick. He is basically want to preserve the blood of Muslims. Amr ibn al-As, he have also another agenda. Not only he wants to preserve the blood of Muslims, but also he wants to stay in power, and Ali will not give him power. However, he said, listen, this Muawiyah and this Ali are troublemakers, and the blood of Muslims have been spilled because of them. let us both of us deny them, denounce them, and let the Muslims to choose a new blood coming, a new, a fresh start. Let the Muslims have a fresh start. Then he said, okay. He said, why don't you have my son, Amr ibn al-As, son of Amr ibn al-As, which is Ibn Amr ibn al-As. Then he said, no, your son, it means you. Plus your son, I don't think he will accept this. He said, why don't you have this? Then when he failed to convince him about his son, he said, okay, let's agree about that, we denounce them both. So you will go, you denounce Ali, and I will go, I denounce Muawiyah, and tell the Muslims, now choose a proper leader amongst yourself, and let the problem to be solved out, and no problem. Okay. It came the time and the day where they should announce the result. They announced the result, they came, they said, Amr ibn al-As, he said, you are before me in Islam, and you are the companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said many hadiths good about you, so you come the first, and you do what we have agreed upon. Then he came, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he stand, he said, oh, you people, you have been killing each other, we supposed to do jihad against other enemy, and this and that, the enemies of Islam are starting attacking us, and so on and so forth. So, I am now denouncing Imam Ali, as he gave me the authority to do anything. I'm now denouncing him, and I'm saying that he is not the Khalifa anymore, and the Khalifa should look for somebody else. And everybody was crazy. What is going on? That was the judgment of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. However, then Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he went down. Then it came Amr ibn al-As to do what? He said, and I am endorsing Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan to become the Khalifa for Muslims, because Muslims cannot stay without Khalifa. And he's capable of doing so, and his blood is clean, and he did not interfere in the killing of Osman and this and that and that. So the Muslims in the party of Amr ibn al-As, they became very happy because their leader became Khalifa, and they become the very close soldiers to the Khalifa, the private soldiers for the Khalifa. And the people in the Imam Ali's camp, they were nearly eating each other. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, when he see the trick happen to him, he escaped. He left the area altogether. He went to Mecca and he was hiding. He was in a shame of himself. Then the Khawarij, they call Ali a kafir at this time, and they call also Muawiyah a kafir. They said they are both kafirs, and they have done against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ali, he said, look, these people, he gathered the people, he said to his camp, look, these two persons have not ruled by Allah's Sharia, because there is nothing in Allah's Sharia to say that they denounce the Khalifa. They went to reconciliate between two people. They had no authority to denounce the Khalifa, and this is in Islamic. So we must go on and fight them again. And then he went back to Kufa to prepare for the fight. And then he sent to the Khawarij. He said, look, you wanted me to go and fight again. Now the situation is ready, and these two people did not fight, did not rule by Allah's Sharia, and they have done a mistake. He said, look, he didn't say they have become a kafir, because this is ijtihad from them. They have done according, they have ruled with their own whims without having evidence. So he said, we shall now continue the fight. They answer him back, they said, no. We ask you to be angry for the sake of Allah first place. So you fight for the sake of Allah first place. Now you're going to fight for your own self. You are angry for your position as a Khalifa. You are not angry for Allah. We will not go with you and fight with these people unless you do what? Unless you say that Muawiyah is a kafir and you also became a kafir. If you witness that, then we will look if we can help you or not. Then Ali ibn Abi Talib said, what are you talking about? After my hijrah with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after my battlefield with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after all I have done in Islam, I witnessed that I am a kafir. What are you talking about? You must be joking. Then they became very vicious and said, don't talk to us and don't send us anybody else. While they're doing so, they start spilling the blood of Muslims. Ali was preparing to go and fight. He said, we'll leave them and we'll go and fight Muawiyah, and when we'll come back, we'll see maybe they came back to their own mind. Then some Sahaba said, no, they start already spilling the blood of people. They were stopping people in the road, tell them, what do you think about this, what do you think about that. Among those who stopped them, there were four women. They've killed them of their ideas. When they asked them to swear at Ali, they refused, they've killed them. So they start getting the haram blood. Then they caught Abdullah ibn Khabbab ibn Arat. Khabbab ibn Arat is one of the companions of Rasulullah, and many ayahs have been revealed because of this man, radiallahu anhu. They caught his son with his wife, she was pregnant. He said to them, ha, who are you? He said, I'm Abdullah ibn Khabbab ibn Arat. He said, Allahu Akbar, your father, what do you say? You are one of them, he said. What do you say about the Khilafah time for Abu Bakr Siddiq? He said, MashaAllah, he was good. What about Umar? He said, MashaAllah, he was good. What about Uthman? He said, MashaAllah, he was good, but people did not like him, but he was good. He said, ah, you are one of them. Because some of them shared in the killing of Uthman, radiallahu anhu. He said, what about Ali? He said, Ali is good. If you help him, he will be even good, but you are not willing to help. And you're not willing to stay aside and to keep quiet. He said, now we know that you are just not saying the truth. You're just trying to you believing in people. You don't believe in the truth. You should be only believing in the truth. Allah. You see how they're using the words of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah in this. Then they tied him up. They tied him up. As they've been tying him up, there was a date. They tied him up in a bustan, which is called in a place belonging to a Christian person, I think. Then one of the dates dropped from the tree. One of the dates dropped from the tree, and one of the Khawarij, he wants to eat it. Then the other person said, why do you eat it? Did you pay for it? He doesn't know what's going to happen to him. He said, you've killed the pig. And the man is paying his tax to the Muslims. You're not supposed to kill his pig. Then the man came and they gave him one. He said, sorry, we have killed your pig. Look, يَقْتُلُونَ أَهْلِ الْإِسْلَامِ وَيَدَعُونَ أَهْلِ الْأَوْثَانِ. They are killing the Muslims. Look at the hadith of Rasulullah. They're killing Muslims and they're leaving alone the non-Muslims. Then he said, I'm sorry, I've killed your pig. How much is this? And he gave him the money for it. Then Abdullah ibn Khabbab ibn Arat, he said, if what I see is right, I shouldn't be worried about myself. A man is afraid to eat a date, and a man is paying a Christian a price for his pig. He said, I shouldn't be worried about myself. I'm okay, guys. You are right. I said, no, you are not okay. You are one of them. Then they killed him. And they killed his wife, and they take the child out of it. Said, we will kill you a kill which nobody have been killed before. And they killed him, and they killed his wife, radiallahu anhu, and they take the baby out. Then when this happened, then Ali ibn Abi Talib, the news came and he said, now you started getting the Muslim blood. If you don't repent to Allah and you pay the blood money for this man and for the four women you have killed and for his wife, then I will start with you before I fight Muawiyah again. They refused. He sent Abu Ayyub al-Ansari to them to talk to them. Then some of them, they came back. He said, if you don't come, we will finish you up. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said to the people, the hadith of Rasulullah, wallahi, if you fight them, not even 10 of you will be killed. And they will all be killed. And then they prepare for the fight, and they were talking to them, giving them the evidence and the hadith of Rasulullah. Then they start saying, Abu, the followers of Abdullah ibn Wahb, they start saying, don't talk to them anymore. Just prepare yourself for Jannah. And don't talk to them anymore. And they keep crying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, as if they are actually on the truth. Allahu Akbar. Then the fight starts and they were all killed. Then Ali ibn Abi Talib, he was looking for a sign that these are the people of the Khawarij. Where Rasulullah he said, among them it will be a man with that little bosom in his hand. And he found him, he was in a hole. He said, Allahu Akbar, by Allah, I was never lying. And no lies have been telling to me by Rasulullah. This is the man which you all know about the hadith. And that is their story. Then the people who have gone out of this the Khawarij people. Some of them, we still have the ideas of the Khawarij. They came in the second generation of Khawarij. That was the end of the generation of the Khawarij in the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib. But some of them, they came again, as we narrated the hadith of Abu Umama, when he see them on Damascus, when they have been killed by the Amawi Khalifa later. He said they are the Khawarij as well, because they have the same ideas, spilling blood and going out of a legitimate ruler. However, that was the story behind the Khawarij. And that was the definition of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Khawarij. But is now, these people are dangerous. Their idea is very, very dangerous. And the main category about their idea, as we repeat again, Ali ibn Abi Talib did not call Muawiyah Khawarij when he come out of his path, because he had a shubha. He said, get me the blood of Osman first and then I will follow you. Although Ali was a legitimate ruler, after them it came some wrongdoers from the Bani Umayyah. After Ali died, Al-Hasan, he was a Khalifa for 6 months, and he was preparing to fight Muawiyah, because he did not call Muawiyah Khawarij. In the end, when he find that his followers are not all up to standard to fight Muawiyah, he give the Khilafah to Muawiyah. How come he give a Khilafah to Khawarij? He said, okay, I'm not going to be a Khalifa anymore. You will be the Khalifa, but you must follow the way of Abu Bakr Siddiq, Umar ibn Khattab, Uthman ibn Affan, and Ali, the Khulafa al-Rashidin. He accepted, and it was the day of reconciliation. And his followers tried to kill him because Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu, he gave up to Muawiyah, tried to kill him. They stabbed him, as we will talk when we talk about the Shia. However, after Al-Hasan died, Muawiyah also died. Came the son of Muawiyah, Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Yazid ibn Muawiyah, he have done many mistakes. Even some of the people of the history, some of them they curse him, some of them they say bad, and Allahu Akbar. However, Yazid al-Husayn, the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's being given some message from Kufa. You are supposed to be the Khalifa. He's not. Come, we will support you. So he went there and he gathered his people, although the advice was against that. Ibn Abbas said to him, no, don't do that. He said to him, he didn't say to him, don't do that because you're going to be Khawarij. He said, don't do that because this mistake is done by this Khalifa. And the people you're going to support, you are the same people who have killed your brother, killed your Ali ibn Abi Talib, and make a lot of problem for him. And the same people who are, Ali ibn Abi Talib was killed by the Khawarij again. One of the Khawarij, he decided, the big enemies of Islam is Ali ibn Abi Talib. He said, Amr ibn al-As, because the one he caused the fitna of Tahkim, and Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. So let's kill the three of them and the whole Muslim Ummah will be fine. And somebody went, Abdullah ibn Maljam, alayhim Allah may yastahaq wa la'ayin Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdullah ibn Maljam, he was supposed to kill Ali. So he start poisoning his sword for 1 month. And when he saw Ali ibn Abi Talib, although Ali ibn Abi Talib, he knew, he said to him, Abdullah ibn Maljam is there and he's saying some poems that he will kill you. Shall we arrest him? He said, no, don't arrest him. How can I arrest him for whatever something he has in his own heart? He said, shall we kick him out? He said, how can I kick him out? He's a Muslim. He comes to pray. Look at the justice of Imam Ali. And then he waited for him when he's going for Fajr and he killed him. He knew he's going to kill him. In our rulers, if they hear somebody is just saying a word or writing a paper in the other end of earth, they go and hunt for him to kill him. Imam Ali knew that the man was going to kill him. And the Muslims, they were volunteering to be mukhabarat for Imam Ali. They were watching anybody who was trying to kill Imam Ali. But he said, I can't arrest the man for what he has inside his heart. And the person who was supposed to kill, from the Khawarij, who was supposed to kill Muawiyah, he only injured him in his backside. And the Amr ibn al-As was saved nearly, or maybe injured a little bit. However, they succeeded to kill Ali ibn Abi Talib. When Al-Husayn went to go out of Yazid, and Yazid was a Khalifa, they took the bay'ah for him by sword. He said, if you don't give bay'ah, I will kill you. However, they gave him the bay'ah, and then he asked Al-Husayn to give him bay'ah. He said, no, I'm not going to give you bay'ah. And he went to Kufa to get his supporters. Ibn Abbas, he didn't tell him, oh, don't go out of the Khalifa because you're going to be a Khawarij. He said, if you want to go and if you want somebody to support you, go to Yemen. So he's telling him to be a Khawarij. Is he telling him to be a Khawarij? No. Because Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah differentiate between Khuruj, between you go out of a Khalifa or you go out of Islam. But the evil scholars, what we live in now, they don't distinguish between that. They know the truth, but they are trying to tell you if you go out of Arura, you are a Khawarij. No, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they differentiate between whoever the Khawarij is, the person who goes out of Islam in his idea. The Khawarij is the person who calls Muslims kafirs because of their sins. The Khawarij who kills the people of Islam and leaves the people of non-Muslims. The Khawarij who goes out of a legitimate Khalifa if he is doing good. But if he's not, but going away from a Khalifa because of some wrongdoing or because of some idea, nobody have called this Khawarij. Never have been in the history. And here is Al-Husayn, he's gone out of Yazid. And he was killed. Did anybody call Al-Husayn Khawarij in history? The son of Rasulullah is a Khawarij. And it's known that he was going to fight. He got his own army. Did anybody call his followers Khawarij? After Yazid, he came Abdullah ibn Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Abdullah, the son of Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, the first child to be born in Medina for Muslims. Until the rumor said that the Jews have been black magic against Muslims, they will never have a boy child. And that was the first son. The son of Asma bint Abi Bakr, the son of Asma. You know who is Asma? Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr, that ibn Taqaym. Well, many hadiths with regard to Asma. Allahu Akbar. Again, he went out of Yazid. He went out of the Khalifa. And he was given bay'ah as well in Mecca. So anybody said that he's gone out of a Khalifa and Abdullah ibn Zubayr is a Khawarij. Anybody said that the followers of Abdullah ibn Zubayr is a Khawarij, he's been killed. And he's been hanged for 3 days and three nights until his body was going disintegrating. Until his mother Asma, she asked that criminal, Al-Hajjaj, Ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, how many people have killed Al-Hajjaj? Anybody called Al-Hajjaj Khawarij? She asked him, isn't that enough time for him to go down? The son of Asma, to be put as an example in the front of all Muslims, in the front of the Sahaba. But nobody said he's a Khawarij. And many of them after many people are come after them, they've gone out of the rulers. Some of them they've gone out of a very famous ruler like Harun al-Rashid. Who's gone out of Harun al-Rashid? Musa al-Kazim is one of the greatest scholars, the son of Muhammad al-Baqir, the grandson of Muhammad al-Baqir. He's gone out of the Khalifa Harun al-Rashid, and he was arrested and he was killed in prison. And Muhammad ibn Ja'far al-Sadiq, also have gone against Harun al-Rashid. He went out and he was given bay'ah in Mecca. The people of Mecca give him bay'ah. Anybody said that he's a Khawarij? Again, it's true. A Khalifa, a legitimate Khalifa. Who have Harun al-Rashid used to say to the sky when he sees some cloud, he said, you can go east or west, wherever you're going to drop your water, your goods will come to me. Because of his army everywhere doing jihad against the kuffar everywhere. Did anybody say, oh, you're making a problem for a Khalifa who is doing jihad and who is doing that and he's doing this and you are killing the Muslim people and you're living alone? Again, it's Harun al-Rashid. Allahu Akbar. And also Al-Husayn, the grandson of Al-Hasan. Al-Hasan is the son of Ali. He had grandson, is called Al-Husayn. Again, he's gone out of Al-Khalifa Al-Hadi until he was killed. He was killed and he was left without being buried. Until the small flies, the small birds were eaten from his body in the front of people. Nobody dares to bury him. Has anybody from the scholars of Islam have called him a Khawarij? No. because the scholars of Islam, they differentiate between going out of a legitimate Khalifa because of some wrongdoing and going out of Islam and going out of Islamic ideas. These people, they say these rulers are wrongdoers, although they've been doing jihad, although they've been applying the Sharia, although they, but they said there is some wrongdoing going about, there is some unfair distribution of the wealth, there is some this and that, and they've gone out of their way. But they were never called Khawarij. They have the same, they believe Allah is in the Sama, they believe in jihad, they believe in everything. All what they believe is that we should not keep quiet about some wrongdoing. Were they called Khawarij? No. Come a bit further to our time to see how much dirty our scholars are nowadays. Very dirty, disgusting. Come a bit clearer, come a bit nearer. In the time of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, what was the Khilafah? The Uthman Khilafah. There's a hadith of the Uthman Khilafah that one of the best Amirs will be from among us, the Uthman Khilafah. Khayrul Amir, Amir al-Fath. The best Amir is the Amir al-Fath, the one who will conquer, who will take over Constantine, the land of Heracles. The best army is that army. And the best Amir is that Amir from the Uthman Khilafah. Who's gone against the Uthman Khilafah? Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, with the family of Al-Saud. He was strict. Yes, he went to enjoin the good and forbid the evil, because there were many, many grave worshippers. But he's gone against who? A legitimate Khalifa. To give the rule to who? To the cowboys of Al-Saud. Did anybody from the scholars call him Khawarij? And he really destructed the Uthman Khilafah. And the descendants of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, he was doing what he think he was good. His belief is good, his aqidah is good. But he's done a mistake. Because many of the scholars before him, they have gone against the Khilafah to enjoin the good and forbid the evil, and then they hand over the power again to the Khalifa. Like the scholar in the time of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, when there is a lot of killing and wrongdoing and kidnapping women, then he said to his students, "Is no longer we're going to stay here in the mosque teaching while all this haram thing happen around us." Then he took his students and he was enjoying the good, forbidding the evil, and he was killing the people who were ambushing Muslims, until somebody says to the Khalifa, "He's going to get stronger and stronger, and he will come attack you to change, to take power." Then he sent him an army and he killed him. What did Imam Ahmad say about him? He's a Khawarij. No, he said, "Rahimahullah, jada bi nafsi." May Allah give him mercy. He have sacrificed himself and his knowledge because of enjoying the good and forbidding the evil. In many times when the Khalifa, it is not enough reasons to go out of him, out of his path, or to go against him, many scholars, many knowledgeable people, they go enjoying the good, forbid the evil, then they hand power again to the Khalifa. Muhammad ibn Abdul did not do that, because Al Saud, they wanted the power. And he wanted to clean the peninsula from shirk. And the result of that, the destruction of the Uthman Khalifa, the Uthman Khilafa. The destruction of the Uthman Khilafa is coming to his 80 years now. The descendants of Al Saud, all what they have done is they have destructed the Uthman Khilafa. Amongst them, there is still plenty of Shia. Amongst them, in the peninsula, there is still plenty of poverty, plenty of shirk. Now people going back to Sufism, and there, so they have, after they manage to destruct the Uthman Khilafah, they have put their dirty hands with the British, cooperating and collaborating against the Islamic State. They have done all what they could to destroy the Uthman Khilafah. And their scholars did not say they are Khawarij. And it will result now that the Ummah does not have a Khilafah. So who is the Khawarij? And they have the guts, after they destroyed the Khilafah, they have the guts and the cheeks to tell us they are legitimate rulers. And they are thieves. And amongst themselves, even in the history of Al-Saud, if you read about the history of Al-Saud, they are all killing each other and taking power from each other. And getting sometimes women booty from each other. Or at least from other tribes. Why they are not Khawarij then? Why the scholars of the time, they said to them, oh, don't go out of your brother, he's your ruler and he's your brother, if you go out, you're a Khawarij. Ibn Baz himself, he signed some paper for one of their kings to go against his brother, to have him arrested. So why he doesn't call him a Khawarij? Do you understand now the difference between our scholars and the previous scholars? Our scholars, you say anything to enjoin the good or forbid the evil, they say, oh, you're a Khawarij. Anything who upsets the king, anything who upsets the kings, is everything who upsets the, is everything who also upset the White House. So they have resulted in the destruction of Islam. The Ottoman Khilafah, the Jews have given the last Khalifa of the Ottoman Khilafah, you have given him anything, we give you anything, just allow us to stay in Jerusalem, not to take it, just stay. He said, any one of you who stayed in Jerusalem, Sultan Abdul Hamid rahimahullah, for more than 3 days, by Allah, I will have his head chopped. He said, okay, we will take it, and you will see. And they cooperate against him, they made the Jewish of Dunama, they accepted Islam and they start destructing Islam from the inside. With the help of the Saudi family from outside, they've destructed the Khilafah. They have destructed the Khilafah. Then they give the place to Ataturk and then he denounced the Khilafah. And here, and me and you now, we are on the pavement of Europe because of the evil of the scholars of Al-Saud. Because of Al-Saud and their scholars. Because they have used Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Who I'm saying now, if Muhammad ibn Wahhab is not a Khawarij going against a legitimate Khalifa, are we Khawarij to go against that drunk, crook, customer of Playboy, Christmas gift man to London Zoo, and all the whores, the man who placed the Jews and Christians inside the peninsula of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The man, the dirty man and his scholars who sign an everlasting peace treaty with Jews to drop jihad. The man who is a member from the United Nations who fight with the United Nations against any Muslim. If this is a legitimate ruler, who will be illegitimate ruler? If his followers and his scholars are the victorious party, who will be the dirty, defeated, humiliated party? These questions we have right to answer. People who are accusing us when we say this is wrong, this is haram, where is Islam, we want to go and live in the land of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ali ibn Abi Talib was saying to the Khawarij, come and live among your brothers, don't leave us. And these people, when you go there, they kill you. When you go out, you say the truth, they send you somebody to kill you. This is, my dear brothers, the hadith which is concerning the Khawarij, the category of the Khawarij, the history of the Khawarij, and what the ulama have said about the Khawarij, and what the difference between the people who go out of a Khalifa, even if he's a legitimate Khalifa, and the people who go out of Islam. Many brothers, sincere brothers, they don't know these differences. Because of the evil scholars, they tell them, you're going to call the ruler non-Muslims, and he's you know, it's a kufr dun kufr. That was not the truth. When the Khawarij said to Ali, to Ibn Abbas, they said to him, some of them, they are not ruled by, they didn't rule according to Islam. So isn't that kufr? He said, it is not the kufr which you are thinking of. Look at this word. It is not the kufr which you are. What does it mean, you are? It means it's a certain condition for a certain time. It's a fatwa. It is not hukm al-shar'. Hukm al-shar'. It whatever is good for every time. And then when its condition applies, then it can apply as a fatwa. The fatwa is two things. Is the reality and what Allah said about the matter. Is our reality, is the same reality of Ali ibn Abi Talib and Muawiyah? Do we have Ali ibn Abi Talib and Muawiyah or anybody near them or anybody apply the Sharia like them? They have appointed two people to think Islamically and to judge. And these two people have gone against Islam according to their understanding. They did not put the Sharia in the dustbin. They did not put the red pen in the Quran. They did not legislate other than Allah's Sharia. So how come you use this fatwa for different place, for different people, for different purpose? and against your own brothers, anybody who enjoins the good and forbid the evil. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, my ummah will never unify in error. You want us to follow you, to all of us to be unified in error, that we all accept that Jews stays in the peninsula, in Palestine forever, and Jews and the Christians and the Jews stay in the peninsula forever, and there is no jihad against them forever. Who's misguided and who's guided and who's saying with the Quran and the Sunnah? Do you want us to unify in that error for you? You are not even saying it's an error. You want us to unify in that practical error, in that theoretical error. You want us to unify in that we keep quiet about all these banks going around the peninsula, riba, usury. You want us to be a part of your fight against Allah, otherwise we are a Khawarij. What you are asking us exactly for? What are you asking us? Tell us. If we say no, we are Khawarij. If we say yes, we are Khawarij in the sight of Allah. The Khawarij are the people who go against the Sharia, not against people who are going against the ruler who are going against the Sharia. We are supposed to go against the people who go against the Sharia, even if they are our fathers, even if they are our mothers, even if they are our children. I don't know what these people are asking us for. I don't know what they own about when they say Khawarij, Khawarij. But I know that they are evil, and I know they are a result of every evil. Now, the Americans have pulled back in hitting Saddam for many reasons, because people are boiling and they start seeing the dirty school as what they are. For the second reason, who's going to pay the bills? Who's going to pay? They charge them $30 an hour for each soldier, for each soldier to be there, plus equipment. And now, the dirty scholars of Arabia are just about again to sign another golden egg for the kafirs, which is to introduce tax for people. Tax. You know what legitimately, making tax is kufr, do you know that? And Rasulullah ﷺ, when the woman was stoned to death, and somebody said, oh, the blood of adultera have came to my clothes, then Rasulullah ﷺ, he said to him, what? He said, wallahi, she repented. Her repentance, if it's distributed amongst the whole Medina, would be enough for them. Her repentance, if a person who is a tax collector repents to Allah, Allah will accept from him. It shows you how much a tax collector needs to repent. How big is the sin of a tax collector? What about a tax legislator? Instead of people paying the zakah, they ask them to pay the tax. Why they want to reduce the tax? Because they want to pay the bills for to kill their own brothers in Iraq and anywhere, anybody else whom the Jews and Christians they don't like and they dislike. This is our situation now, my dear brothers, and what we have to understand now. That these people, although they call anybody who attacked their regimes Khawarij, at the same time they are willing to take any un-Islamic thing from these people. The wearing of the cross, what we said about the wearing of the cross in Ibn Baz, what he said. They said to him, look, he's a cross. He said, even if it's a cross. You know what the scholars said about the unanimous about the scholars? Anybody wears a sign of kufr, knowing it's a sign of kufr, he is non-Muslim. He becomes a kafir. And the man is wearing the cross for 3 days, 3 nights, and until now, how many years now? How many years before? Until now he did not say sorry to Muslims, he did not repent, he did not reject the gift. But it shows, everything is consistent, everything is okay. When Abdel Nasser needed the help of Russia against America and against Jew, there was the fatwa of Ibn Baz as well, saying that nobody is allowed to use non-Muslims against non-Muslims. We are not allowed to use the help of kafir against kafir. And he gave the same fatwa to help the kafir against Muslims. Allahu Akbar. It shows the dirt stinks. But for those who are willing not to smell, or willing not to see, or willing not to hear, So these people, which we call them Shaykhism, they have different, they are not even Murji'ah. They are not even Murji'ah. You know what's the Murji'ah? Murji'ah are the people who came against. Every bid'ah have a counter bid'ah. The Khawarij used to call people non-Muslims because of sins, and the Murji'ah used to call non-Muslims Muslims. Even if they do kufr, they said, oh, as long as they say la ilaha illallah. And some of them, if we will talk about later, some of these Murji'ah, the scholars have called them non-Muslims, because they said the belief is in the heart. That means the Pharaoh is a Muslim, and because he knows about Allah and everybody. However, but these people, we cannot even call them Murji'ah, because the Murji'ah, they are consistent. They don't contradict themselves. They have a bad belief, which when you read their paper, you know what they believe. You can ask them, you can argue with them, you can write against them. But these people, they are twisters, they are snakes. They are snakes. They go against, they have the fatwa and the opposite of the fatwa. They have the fatwa and the film, the negative of the fatwa. Sometimes they give the fatwa when it's in the interest of the leader. So other times they give the negative of the fatwa if it's in the interest of the leader. And you have to work with them round the clock in 180 degrees possibility. And this is a situation. And the other thing we have to warn about is not only these rulers, but also the Khawarij of our time as well. We have to warn against them. That in our lands now, there is Islam and Kufr. And this is a mixed land. When Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah says, in a mixed land, you have to deal with Muslims as Muslims, and you have to deal and kill Kafirs as they are Kafirs. Because we are in Kufr now, it's called the mixed land, Dar al-Mukhtarifa. So you will have Muslims, and you will have Kafirs, and you will have in between them. So you will have Muslims, and you will have Kafirs, and you will have in between them. So you must first protect the Muslims and also punish the Kafirs. Otherwise, the balance will be unbalanced. You have to balance Islam and Kufr. So the people who are legislating, who are fighting against Islamic rules, fighting against Islamic people, they are targets of Islam. They should be killed. Amongst them, there will be some weak and needy and helpless and silly people whom, when they see the authority of Islam, they become Muslims. When they see the authority of Kufr, they become Kafirs. So with these people, as long as they mind their own business, they should be left alone. Here comes another thing now. Amongst all the brothers, the sincere brothers, there is some sincere brothers are tricked by the scholars of the Arabia, that they are not willing even to say what is wrong and what is right. But there is some other brothers are revolutionary. They can see the Kufr of these leaders very clear. But then the shaitan is not going to leave them alone. It's very clear, they see. The kufr is very clear. That means if somebody does not call them a kafir, then he becomes a kafir himself. No. This is not right. This is not correct. What you see a person, when you see a person is not a Muslim, when you see a person is a kafir because of some action, it is not necessarily if your brother does not believe he is a kafir, that he becomes a kafir. No, my dear brothers, this is also, we have to be just in ourselves. And this actually, which was one of the Khawarij of our time and the previous time. You can see somebody a kafir. You can see him. He's very clear. Your brother cannot see that because of his kind of knowledge, his lack of knowledge, or maybe his lack of fear, or maybe his fear. So you can't say to him, well, look what he's doing. Look what he's doing, he's a kafir. He can't say, no, I don't see him as a kafir. Then you don't tell him, oh, you don't see him as a kafir, you become a kafir. Because the person who does not call the disbelievers kafir, he becomes a kafir. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he has said this, if you don't call the mushriks mushriks, then you are a kafir or a mushrik yourself. Yes, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab said this, rahimahullah. And yes, we agree with this statement. And yes, this is unanimously also, Muhammad al-Wahhab, he did not get this statement from his own mind. He got it also from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. If you don't call mushriks mushrik, you are a mushrik. If you don't call kafirs kafirs, you are a kafir. But which mushrik and which kafir? The mushrik and the kafir, which is written in the Quran and the Sunnah explicitly about him. If you don't call the Christians, if somebody says to you, I'm a Christian, am I a Muslim or a kafir? Then you are a kafir. If you say otherwise, then you yourself are not a Muslim. Because, not because of him, because you are calling the Quran a liar. Because Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ. Allah distinguished between two kinds of kufr. The kufr of al-mushrikeen, the pagans, the idol they worship, and the kufr of the people of the book. The people of the book, the people of the scriptures. They are kafirs, but they are still people of the book, because they are kafirs of some of the holy message. They are kafir with regard to Allah. They call him three instead of one, but they know there is Allah. They have a sharia, they have a book, but they still kafir. So when the scholars say whoever does not call a kafir, it is not the kafir which you have in mind. It is the kafir who have been identified in the Quran and the Sunnah as a kafir. When rahimahullah Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Imam al-Shafi'i, they are good examples for us. With regard to the person who is not praying, they have a munazara. They sat together. Then they said, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said, with regard to the person who does not pray, I have hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is a correct hadith, three hadiths. He said, whoever leaves the prayer, he is a kafir. Whoever leaves the prayer, he is a mushrik. Whoever leaves the prayer, he is a kafir and mushrik. These three hadiths is enough for me to can say happily that the person who leaves the prayer, he is a kafir. Then Imam Shafi'i is very clever. He's not easy person. He's a very clever person. He used to say about Imam Shafi'i, he can convince you that pillar, if it's made from concrete, he can convince you that it's made of gold. He have that ability. He said to him, okay, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, if he is a kafir, how come he enters Islam again? Imam Ahmad said, he just have to say La ilaha illallah. He said, but he says it. Then he didn't say Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal anything. The wrong answer from Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, it doesn't mean the right concept of Imam Shafi'i. Because the right answer for that is that how come he become a Muslim again? How should he become a Muslim again? The right answer for it is what the people of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah said, whoever leaves Islam because of a certain thing, he goes inside Islam back again. If he stops doing that certain thing, or he starts doing what he gets him out of Islam for not doing. So the right answer for it is to start praying again. If he wants to become a Muslim again, he should start praying again. But he did not give the answer, but he was not arguing person. What we want to learn from this situation, my dear brothers, he did not tell him, look Shafi'i, I have a hadith, and he says, whoever does not pray is a kafir, and you don't call the kafir a kafir, so you are a kafir. That never happened. And that should never happen. Because we all have different education. We all have different mentalities. If you see somebody which is not a Jew or a Christian, if you see somebody doing action of kufr, for example, and you have applied the ways of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah to investigate the action of kufr, people of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, before you investigate the kufr, you must first know it's kufr. It could not be kufr. Something which you say it's kufr, it could not be, it could be not kufr. Then once it's established that this action is kufr, then you must also apply the way of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah to make sure that that person is a kafir. Because he could be doing kufr, but he's not a kafir. He could be doing kufr, but he's not a kafir. Very easy. Very, very easy. Somebody could be doing kufr, but he's not a kafir. Like, for example, in our land, in our places now, this is a place, for example, of non-Islamic place. Some children grown in this country, they don't know anything about Islam. Their parents they are criminals. They brought them in this country. And then here a girl, she comes, she didn't learn anything about Islam. She ran from home, she married a Christian. Any Muslim girl marry a Christian or non-Muslim, she's a kafir, isn't she? But is this girl a kafir? Not necessarily. Do you understand? Because that will be kufr in our land. It's something which is known by the community. It's something which she's been taught. It's something which is everything everybody knows. And she will not be allowed. And if she does it, she will do it against the community. And everybody else will know about it. In this society, no. She loved somebody and she went in a sin. And even if she goes for a sin, she's a sinner. But she thinks if she marries is better. Then she thinks, why did you marry me? Then he marries her. She thinks she's doing good. She's doing kufr. But is she a kafir? No. So even if you establish a kufr is a kufr, and it's known as a kufr, you must make sure that the person who does that kufr, that he is not crazy. He is wise. You must make sure that he is wise. He's got some mind. He's mature. The second thing, you must make sure that he's not ignorant. He's not ignorant. And once he's ignorant and you tell him, then he's not ignorant anymore. So you must make sure that he can understand what is said to him. And he's not ignorant. And you must make sure also that he deliberately make it. He did not make by accident if somebody get the Quran and threw it away. Is that kufr or not kufr? It's kufr if he get the Quran and threw it away. But if he said, oh, I didn't think it's the Quran, I thought it's Salman Rushdie's book. Is he a kafir? He's not kafir. So he's ignorant about what he does. But if he said, yes, this is the Quran, and I know this is the Quran, and I'm not a kafir and I'm going to throw it away. Say, no, you are a kafir and you're going to throw it away. Because you do it deliberately and you know it's the Quran and it's something which cannot be severable from the respect of Islam. You can't say I'm a Muslim and you make a joke about Rasulullah. You can't say I'm a Muslim and you disrespect the Quran. You can't say I'm a Muslim. Yes? So he can think some people, and this is the most kufr, that people sometimes do kufr and they know what they're doing is right, but they think, if I do it, I'm not going to be a kafir. I said, no. Once you know that you do it deliberately and you know that people have called this kufr, and you do it, then you become a kafir, even if you think you are not a kafir. Like Shaykh al-Islam said, he said, many people, they do kufr, and they don't think it's kufr. But because they know what they are doing, and they deliberately do it, they are not forced, for example. Somebody is forced to say the word of kufr. The action is kufr, but, and he is wise, and he knows what he does it. But because he's pushed for it, then you cannot call him a kafir. Like what? Like the example of Surah Al-Nahl, where the ayahs was revealed of Ammar ibn Yasir, when they forced him to say the word of kufr. And then Rasulullah said, if they force you again, say it again. That word of kufr was swearing about Rasulullah. He said, if you don't swear for Muhammad, if you don't swear against him, then we will kill you. And they tortured him. They killed his mother and father. Yeah? And you must make sure that he's not crazy as well. There's four conditions. يكون ايش؟ عاقلا عالما قاصدا مختارا. He deliberately does the action, not forced. Yeah? And he makes sure that he's not a crazy and he's not forced and he doesn't have even ta'wil. He doesn't have even ta'wil. That means he thinks that is not a kufr because of some ayahs. For example, some women, she had some slaves, and she think because of the ayah Allah said, "Wama malakat aymanukum," whatever is in your position, she thinks she's like men. She can sleep with her slave man as a man can sleep with his slave girl. She slept. She was not stoned to death, and she was not called a kafir because she had ta'wil. What is ta'wil? Is a certain understanding. Because this thing, you don't kill a person for it because it's not repetitive. If it is done and is repeated, or if it is endorsed as a law, then that person is insistent for his kufr, and that person is deliberately fighting Allah, and that person, he knows that he's doing wrong, and especially if he does it over the years, especially if he does it all the time, especially if he argue, especially if you hide the ayat which is against him, then that's a different situation. So before you call somebody a kafir, you must make sure that what he does is a kufr. And you must make sure, if this is a kufr, that he is a person who is liable for that title. And if you are not sure, you don't say. You say, at least he's a rundua, and I need to fight him, without saying, until what? Until you find somebody is knowledgeable, or until somebody give you evidence, and the other people failing to give you evidence, it's okay. So this is something we have to advise our brothers as well, because we are seeking knowledge to apply Islam, we're not seeking knowledge to argue. We are in a very different situation, and a very difficult situation. We are orphans, and we don't need to make it more difficult for us. It's a time now where people are going to buy and sell the religion for pennies, and for umrah, and for some bills for the center. Yes, you will find these kind of people, but don't be like that. And also, your heat for Islam, your love for Islam, should not stop you from being just. Should not stop you from understanding what you knew today, you did not know yesterday. So don't think and assume and force everybody to know it. So if somebody said to you, I will call him a dog, I will call him this, but I'm not going to call him a kafir. Jazakallah khair. You have called him what he should be. He's a dog, he's this and he's that. And it's not necessarily they can call him a kafir, but search fi sabilillah. And if he's doing this and doing that, then at least try to repair. Me and you agree that these things are wrong. Maybe we disagree that these people, the rulers are now, they are kafir. Maybe we disagree about that. But aren't we agree that these many errors needs to be corrected, needs to be unified? Aren't we agreed that the people who fight these people and say the word of the truth when they are in prison, they are our brothers and sisters, they need help, they need support, and they need and they need every kind of love from our hearts, even if some of them are doing some mistakes. Because when you work and you mistake, you are much nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the people who are watching from the window or watching from the news doing nothing. When you work, you will do mistakes. You will say mistakes. When you take a lot, when you talk a lot, you will make mistakes. When you don't talk at all, you will make no mistakes. But Islam said, work and talk, make wrong and repent, learn from mistakes, and go ahead. If we don't do that, by Allah, how did Islam reach Pakistan and India and Egypt? If the Sahaba just went to sit down and have nice atmosphere and nice white galabiyas and miswak and nice ithra, and they want to stay where everyone have four wives, we would have been a pagans until now. We just worship and I'm probably be the descendants of the Pharaoh, become, or maybe one of you become, you know, from the Genghis Khan people. So this is how to carry the message, and this is how we deliver the message, and we have to be fair, and we are open. Knowledge in closed doors dangerous. Many people say, but we can't talk about these people openly because Abu Huraira and some of the Sahaba said, if you talk openly about these people, maybe some idiots will understand it wrong. He said, no. Ibn Taymiyyah said, don't say that. Ibn Taymiyyah said, people will talk about Islam when there is a point against them, then they will say this kind of general terms. Not every knowledge to be said. No, my dear brothers. When knowledge is according to aqeedah with regard to Islam and kufr, it must be said. Because Rasulullah ﷺ said, the halal is clear and the haram is clear. That means the belief is more clear. We're not talking about points of fiqh here. We're talking about points of belief. Who is a believer, who is not a believer, who should be fought, who should we give our support, who should we pray for him when we prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who should we curse him on the pulpit of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and who should we let our sisters to marry, and who we should see our soul. And in the end, the Sahaba, they made it very clear to conclude that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to the hadith narrated in Imam Ibn Taymiyyah in the volume 35, page 353, he said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have ordered us, in the authority of Jabir ibn Abdullah, to hit with this, the sword. Whoever goes out of this, the Quran. So even if we have a dispute amongst us, there is many points of agreements. Don't make the disputes amongst us, which is a little black spot in a very white page. Don't make them obstacles. Let us work with what we agree about it. And let us clean our ummah. Who's going to clean our ummah if we don't? Who's going to clean our ummah from zina? Who's going to clean our ummah from riba? Who's going to clean our ummah from banks? Who's going to clean our ummah from un-Islamic court? Who's going to clean our ummah from dirty Jews and Christians? Who? Who? Who's going to spill the blood? These things to change, it needs blood. And if the other people have made one Islamic village through their own means, wallahi, we would have asked them. We said, okay, we believe now you can make an Islamic place. But they haven't. They have failed. And it's going from back to worse. Since the Khilafah have been distracted by the Saudi family and by the people who allied themselves to the British, who destroyed the Khilafah. Since then, it's going from bad to worse, to worse, to worse. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all guidance. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let us see the enemies of Islam for what they are.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulullah. Step 2, regarding to the Khawarij, questions and answers. The question from brother is a very smart question, actually. It's saying, how come Muhammad al-Nurab is being tricked when he had a fatwa saying that he is the religious leader of the area, and he gave the authority of the area to Al Saud, yeah? It's very simple. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, He had many enemies of his time. The Khalifa of the time, which is the Osman Khalifa, they mean mainly Sufis, but they are not the kind of Sufis which is in Egypt now. They are the Sufis in the, with regard like the Sufis, the Hanafi Sufis are different from the Egyptian Sufis. With regard that the Hanafi Sufis, they believe in jihad, and the Osman Khalifa, and they do jihad, and they do this. However, it results that many grave worshipping at the time. And he has right to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab is a very knowledgeable scholar. And he knew he's not going to be a Khawarij if he goes against the Khalifa, if he's enjoying the good and forbidding the evil. Not like the evil scholars of our time now, if you are enjoying the good and forbidding the evil, they call you Khawarij. So he know he's not going to be a Khawarij if he enjoins the good and forbid the evil. Even though that evil is not done by the Khalifa, it's done by people of his local area. So he knew he's not going to be a Khawarij, and he knew there is many scholars before him, and he knew Al-Hassan, Al-Hussein, and some of the Sahaba, they were doing just so, enjoying the good and forbidding the evil, whether the Khalifa likes it or not. And he gave the authority, to the Saudi family, that he did not tell them, you are the Khalifa. He told them, you are in charge of this kingdom to help me to change the evil of this kingdom. What should have been later, that they should, as the Babars and as the people before, the kings would used to fight the crusades and things like that. They used to fight the crusades, even the Khalifa doesn't want to fight them. But they still make dua for him on the minbar. And they still use his currency. And they still paying him the zakah. They send it to his place. They have not done so. And they were using, in their time, they were using all the money for jihad. And it was okay, it was for jihad. The Saudi family have used him to establish their kingdom. And he have used the Saudi family to unify the people against the fire worship, the grave worshipping and this and that. It was, he was working fi sabilillah, and the Saudi family has always been working fi sabilish shaitan since their start. So that was his ijtihad. If the Muhammad ibn Wahhab at the time have said to them, you should hand over the power to the Khalifa, they would have killed him. And they would have ended up with the grave worshipper and also the British staying there. So that was his ijtihad at the time. But we were trying to get from there. He did not tell them, you are a Khalifa. Because there is already a Khalifa in the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ. If there is two Khalifas, kill the second of them. So what he said, you are in charge. I'm allowing you to charge this religiously because you are helping me to establish Islam. Now, are they now establishing Islam or establishing Kufr? Where is the Sharia? What, in which law say that when you go to Mecca and Medina, women should be veiled, and when they go to Riyadh, they wear a hot short or no short? You go and see them coming from Riyadh. All the Christians, the Arabs, even the Saudis. As soon as they go to the in Riyadh, they wear mini skirts. There's a lot of homosexuals there. And when they go to Jeddah, they have this abaya, what they call it. As soon as they go to the airplane or even inside the transit area, here is it. You are in the Champs-Élysées or Piccadilly Circus. So are they establishing the Sharia? He has been tricked, and also he has been forced to remove, to clean his area. Muhammad Wahhab is a scholar. He cannot stay in an area where there is grave worshipping, and when there is, so he wanted to clean the area using these people, but they were much cleverer than him, because they know once he will go, they will have the paper that they are in charge of the area, and it shows straight away when Muhammad ibn Wahhab rahimahullah passed away, they straight away they allied themselves against the Khilafah, and they went with the biggest enemy against the Khilafah, which was the British and the allies, and they were fighting and bombarding the Khilafah everywhere, and going to everywhere where the Khilafah has authority, like Egypt, like everywhere, fighting against the Khilafah. So he was tricked and he was cornered, but he knew his duty. Muhammad al-Wahhab was not looking for a kingdom, he was looking for a religious status, which is to fight the fire worshippers, the grave worshippers, and the people who used to go and slaughter in the front of the graves. And this is exactly became again like shirk. It became again like the times of Rasulullah ﷺ, when he said, don't slaughter for idols, don't slaughter for dead people, don't worship dead people, don't worship idols. So that was his main thing, is to clear Mecca and clean Mecca. He have done many of this, alhamdulillah. Unfortunately, many of these are coming back. But however, that was his ijtihad, and he was not forced to do so. So he was not odd, Muhammad ibn Wahab, to go against the Osman Khalifa. When there is a lot of wrongdoing in the Ummah, and the Khalifa is not willing to change it. Like now, if we make a force now and go on and fight Jews and Christians in Palestine or even inside the peninsula, then obviously this is the biggest obligation in Islam after saying La ilaha illallah. How can we leave these dirty people very close to the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? It has been proven before that many Christians have tried to steal the body of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi, he has seen Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his dream, saying that protect me from these two blondies. And then he went, he said, what is the two blondies? What is the two blondies? And then he find that there is some people are digging. They have two foreigners with blonde hairs. They were making themselves as worshipping. They have a tent and they are digging. They are trying to dig to the grave of Rasulullah so they can steal his body. And this is why he dig himself around the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he put metal all the way. It's been proven. How can we leave them? Rasulullah ﷺ, he said that they should not be killed, Jews and Christians. The last thing when a man dies, he's saying, is the most important thing, he says. Get rid of Jews and Christians from the peninsula. What bin Baz said, they should stay there. Even though me and you are not allowed to go there. So he has been tricked, and we have been tricked, and there is no harm saying that we have been tricked. But for how long? And this is the time. If we decide now to correct what the illegitimate people, the people who have stolen the Khilafah and have destructed the Khilafah, they should be just killed for that, if they haven't done anything else. Let alone changing the Sharia, let alone getting the women's clothes off, let alone exporting, giving their money for the kafirs against Muslims, let alone dropping the jihad and doing their own jihad just against Muslims. Who's killing the Muslims now and making friends with kafir? The definition of the Khawarij again, who? It's these rulers, not us. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah, the second question. How would you talk about Lord Rawat Jad, mashallah. How would you go around, you call them Qajis as well, killing these rulers? Because this is a lot of imams haven't put into plan. I mean, which the best method? I mean, everybody says jihad and so this and that.
Mm-hmm.
How to run them over now? I mean,
these rulers?
Yeah, these rulers.
There is only one way, brother. How to run these people over? You must first take them out of power. Everybody, it's easy to make a nice video and a camera and talk about jihad. But when it comes to the battlefield, many people go for jihad just because they listen to a nice tape, Sheikh Mas'ud, Mawlana Mas'ud. When they go for the reality and they see the difficulties, they come back. So what am I doing here? There's no... So jihad is the only way to recruit leaders. Anybody else, you give him the microphone, he will talk nice. Even rich people, if they give you some of their money, for you is good, but for him is nothing. And this is not the way to choose leaders. Leaders should come from the battlefield, because if they spill blood, and this is the way of the Sahaba to choose their leaders. I mean, who is the leaders? Abu Bakr Siddiq. Which battle Abu Bakr Siddiq has not been in? Umar ibn Khattab. Which battle Umar ibn Khattab has not been in? Osman ibn Affan. Only the battle of Badr, and Rasulullah said, because his wife, she was sick, and he gave him a portion of the booty. Ali ibn Abi Talib. So who did Khalifa? This is the way to choose your leaders. It's from the battlefield. And the Sahaba, they never used to say, this man is very knowledgeable, this man is good, Surat al-Baqarah is no Surat al-Imran. When they want to praise somebody, the Sahaba, They don't praise talkers. They praise people who have action, people of situation, people who say the truth when it comes, and people who spill their blood fi sabilillah, and people who will never been absent when they were needed. They said, this man, he attended Badr. Regardless, there's many people more knowledgeable than him, but he attended Badr, he attended Uhud, he attended all the battles. Allahu Akbar. This is their CVs. Not he gave a talk, he had a nice tape, he's got a book, a glossy book, he make a fatwa. What's that? What's that? The Quran, with all this light, is light words. If you don't have a sword to protect it, he will be thrown in the toilet. Any kafir now could get your Quran, and we have complaints, brother, go and teach the Quran. Somebody said, can you from next door, please, can you give me the Quran from my colleague in prison? He said, hey, I got the Quran. Oh, I can't put it through the window. Okay, I'll put it. And he kicked the Quran with his foot. He pushed the Quran with his shoe to the brother so he can read some Quran. You can't say anything, he's in prison. In many interrogations in our country, even in Saudi Arabia, even in everywhere, you say to him, if you say something against Islam, you say to him, fear Allah, fear Allah. I said, don't say Allah. If you come Allah, I'll put him here in the drawer for you. This is the kind of conversations we are hearing in our country. So our Ummah needs leaders. Needs leaders from Pakistan, from Egypt, from this. So how can you have leaders? You must, when you see a leader, you say he deserves to be a leader, he's been sacrificing, I can't do like him, so at least the Ummah needs a leader, even if it's an ant, to go around him. But because this leadership is always disputable, and nobody can say this one is better than that one, so the leaders must come by the sword. The leaders who are the first people who launched jihad, then anybody comes, say, Jazakallah khairah, you started, even if you started before me 1 hour, I will listen to you. I will obey you, even if you are less of knowledge. Some people, they start jihad when they only know very little. They just want to change. Here it comes, the years comes, and somebody come very knowledgeable, come with very arrogant, and he said, oh, he knows Bukhari and Muslim and the six books and the Sahih books. Oh, he is knowledgeable. Why don't you make him a leader? He said, shut up, make him a leader. Where he was when I was fighting. And he did not come until we make him a secure way to come. Until we send him a ticket, until we send him people, we need knowledgeable people for jihad, and when he comes here, he wants to be a leader? No. Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi, Muhammad al-Fatih, all these people, they have the scholars supporting them, not pulling the mat from under themselves. And when I was in Bosnia, the Amir of the Jihad was a, mashallah, 20 years old boy. I was very happy that he gave me just a car to drive the wounded. Any scholar, it's an honor for him to go and stay in the land of jihad. It's an honor for him. You shouldn't go there to take. And our leaders now, they should be young. They should be in their 20s years old, because they die like anything. Go. And this is the right way to do it. If you choose your leadership from amongst the talkers, they will never die. Everybody will die and they will never die. But if you choose them from the fighters, here, 1 year. Another one killed. 6 months, another one killed. 6 months. So the Ummah becomes, who wants to be a leader? No, I don't want to be a leader. Why? Because leader, it means I'm going to be like Rasulullah. The Sahaba used to say, Kunna nahtami bi Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We used to seek refuge behind Rasulullah when it comes very hot. We know the enemies are around him. We hide behind him. He goes and fights Rasulullah. Always goes in the front. Allahu Akbar. So now you say, who's going to be a leader? Everybody raise his hand. Yeah, but you fight, we fight behind you. You're not going to be a leader in the back. Exactly like the prayer. One imam in the front and we're all behind you. So you're going to be in the front. Are you going to be a leader? He said, no, I don't want to be a leader. Wallahi, I tell you, this is the truth. So once become, even the Mu'tazilis, they used to choose the leader like that. Said, our leader must be a fighter. Why did we lose Islam? How did we lose Islam? That we are not interested to fight. And everybody interested to fight. So we leave in, people come and look our backside here. We are here. We said, oh, okay, but we are not here. Jazakallah khair, we are not here. And what do you want to take? Take. Okay, I'm not here. Take. Until they are sharks now. They are eating the real meat and we are happy for the crumbs. Which drops. And even that crumbs is the blood of our brothers and sisters. Even that crumbs is the booty. What they are taking these Christians from our brothers and sisters, and what we are taking from them as a social security and all these grants in the schools,
is the crumbs of what you have taken as a booty from your brothers and sisters from our Muslim land. So without you realizing, you are sharing the crime. So our leaders should come from the battlefield so they are undisputable, and anybody else should be utility for them. And if we cannot do it, we intend to do it. And if we cannot support them by our blood, we support them by our mouth. We support them by our money. We support them by our children. We say to them, there's no harm of saying to our children, look, we have done a mistake. Look, we have been lazy. Look, we are sinners. You don't be that. It's not going to be an easy solution. And it's not going to be a very easy way with roses all over. It's going to be a bloody way. These people are working hundreds of years to knock our Khilafah down, and they succeeded after hundreds of years. And we're not going to turn the table over in just a couple of months with some slogans or some videotapes. It's going to be bloody. It's going to be, you have to prepare yourself. And the price is Jannah. It's very simple. The price is Jannah. So you sweat, you know, you get killed, you get wounded, this is the way of the Sahaba. Do you think the Sahaba, you look at the Sahaba, they are not having a nice clothes like what we've seen from the Salafis now, and the nice miswak and the nice itr? No, they have holes in their clothes, and they have blood, and when they sit, this one smiles, there's no teeth, and this one has got one eye, and this one has lost one hand, and this one has got he lost half of his nose, and this one has lost one of his ears. And Rasulullah, he lost his teeth. And Rasulullah, he's got an arrow here in his face. And we're not even prepared to have a couple of sticks in our backs before Islam. And some of us willing to sell Islam for £5 extra on his wages. So what Islam are we talking about? So the Sahaba, when they sit, they have all these medals. All these medals, the wounded medal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when you come the day of judgment, anybody who's been injured fi sabilillah in the battlefield, he comes in the day of judgment and his wounds comes with blood, very nice color. The color is blood and the smell is musk. And this is our medals in the day of judgment when you see them. It's medals. It's something when you have seen, even if you have done mistakes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could forgive you for it. So when the ummah don't want medals, and when the ummah, everyone wants to be a leader, nobody wants to be a soldier. Everyone wants to be a Salah ad-Din, but cartoon Salah ad-Din, not a real Salah ad-Din. And then this is what we have to have leaders. We have to respect our leaders, even if they are young. They are young in age, but mature. Muhammad al-Fatih, since he was 10 years old, he was planning when he was 10, since he is 10 years old, planning for the conquering of the Constantine to come under the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Rasulullah said, the best Amir is the Amir of al-Fatih. Even Ali ibn Abi Talib, he sent an army because of this hadith, and he could not open. Muawiyah, he sent an army. All the Sahaba used to go to become, from this hadith, the best army. After how long from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the conquering of Constantine? 830 years. Or say 800 years. After Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the hadith, 800 years, it was open. It's a sign that our Rasul is Rasul and he knows. He did it because any nation could have opened it. It's only Muslims. And the person who opened it, he was determined. So we have to bring up our children to become leaders, and we have to raise for that. So we teach them Quran, so we teach them, and when we have many leaders, there's no harm, as long as they are fighting leaders in the front. Look, Rasulullah, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, Zayd ibn Thabit, Ja'far, three leaders are getting killed, and then the Muslims said, oh, there's no Rasulullah, if the three killed, choose one of you. And the three Amirs were killed. What does that tell us? That to be Amir is to be killed. And this is the way. You go to the battlefield, everybody go, mashallah, you have a battlefield. And when the time to read who is going to be in the first row to attack, the first row people are the people who's going to be killed. You see who is a man and who is not a man. When you know your life is going to end up tomorrow, then you have different feeling. Wallahi, I have seen people crying with their eyes not to be chosen from the first right. From the first row. And I've also seen people crying with their own eyes. I used to think they are very good because they have been chosen in the first row. You have this ummah is like is better than many ummahs, but it has the same.
when you know your life is going to finish tomorrow, you're not going to see your mom, you're not going to see your dad, you're not going to see your friends, and you're not going to see your girl, you're not going to see your things, and your nice computer you bought, and the thing. You know it's going to finish, that is only a couple of hours. So if you take it the first hour, the second hour, the third hour, you're going to faint. And the shaitan will come. Unless you are really solid. Wallahi. And many brothers, this is only very few percentages, but what I'm saying that this is the only way we can choose our leaders. It's not fair to be a coward and a leader. It's not fair to be, because if you are a coward, any time they give you a peaceful proposal, you will accept it. But if you are a fighter, I said, why? What should we? You are here, we are there, we're going to get you. And this is how Islam goes. Muslim from a battlefield, he will always be at the front. And Allah will give him victory, and Allah will give him success. Because the angels, who's going to fight next to the angels? Do we want the angels to fight and we run? So this is why we need a courageous leader. And this is the way of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And to have to be fair, and we send people to the front battle to train. The battle is long. We are fighting kafirs whom don't speak Arabic, and they don't speak the language of Quran, and we are fighting also their supporters who speak Arabic, and they speak the language of Quran. Who's going to change this? It's only people who understand about Islam and people who are given effort. And we must be a fighting nation. Our grandparents were a fighting nation. We are not a fighting nation. They give us books, certificates, and the dish, and we're happy with all that. And they are trained day and night. And they give us weapons which we cannot handle. And we cannot cooperate. And they know the lifetime of this weapon. And they know how to fight them. And they know how to train us. We have to fight them different way. And we have to have our own leaders from our own first believers, then hardworking, and then frontliners.
So how should we move against these trend rulers from these European countries, the youngsters who want to move in against them?
They must go for training, and they must prepare themselves for a thing. And the first ignition of changing these people is enjoying the good and forbid the evil. You can't say to the people in Pakistan, okay, these rulers are kafir, go and change them. How are they going to change them? Some of them are relatives to them. Some of them, and these rulers, they don't rule alone. They have the police forces with them. And some people, they are in the police forces. They become your uncles, they become your brothers, they become your sister's husband. And how can you fight them? The only way to fight these people is to choose target, to say, this is kufr, no brothels. So if he goes to the brothel, he becomes a target. He's not going to say, oh, I'm going to kill you, my brother, because you are a policeman. No. If the police forces have said, we're going to defend the brothels, we're going to defend the courts, we're going to defend the courts which is ruling by other than Allah, we're going to defend the whores, we're going to defend the prostitutes, we're going to defend the usury, we're going to defend this, then they are not a target, but they are in the target area. Then you go, you knock down these places. Some of you will be killed, some of them will be killed. And more comes, becomes viciously. And then people start thinking, well, these people saying Islamically right, and these people are Islamically wrong. Then they're going to start then, oh, but they are Khawarij, they don't change by force, but how going to change? We've been talking to you years and years. We should be talking to you first place. You are Muslims, you are not supposed to be doing this. So you choose your targets. You become man enough, brothers with emirs. No more usury in our country. Full stop. Finish. Even the whole country dies because of that. So what? They die men. Allah asks you, what have you done with the usury you've seen everywhere? What do you tell him? I open a bank account. I had a Barclay card. But I was not taking riba. I was leaving them riba because I'm a fool. I give them my money and also I give them the interest. What's that? No, I've stopped it. I've burned it. I knocked it down. And this is what Muslims have to do. It's dangerous. It's going upside down now. And you find in the same family, you find now a good practicing Muslim, and you find a semi-naked sister, his sister, and his brother is a judge, and his other brother is a policeman, and the other brother is an atheist, he doesn't believe in anything. And one of them, and the other brother is applying for off license. This is in the same family. So you can't start killing your own brothers and sisters, you have to choose targets. sit, your brother, I'll give you da'wah. But wallahi, if I see you among these roads, I will kill you. This is what Sahaba used to do. Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, he said to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he said, oh my father, before I accepted Islam, I was avoiding you in the Battle of Badr because I didn't want to fight you. What did Abu Bakr Siddiq said? That wallahi, if I saw you, I would have killed him. Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah, his father was among the people in the Battle of Badr. He killed him. And for him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the ayahs in the end of Surah Al-Mujadala that you will never find people who loves Allah and loves Rasulullah, will love their families and will love the enemies of Allah, even if they are their parents, even if they are their fathers or their brothers or their sons. And he described these people are the masters of paradise. It's not easy. This is why the Battle of Badr, although it's very few numbers in the involvement, there is many battles after it or before it, was hundreds of thousands of people. But the Battle of Badr is the only battle on earth, on time. It was called the Battle of Furqan, the battle of the real separation. They can throw each other with shoes. They can swear at each other. But when it comes to spill the blood fi sabilillah, the blood of brothers and sisters, then this is the relief, this is the belief, and this is the furqan, this is the line which separates the believer from non-believer. And this is what we have to say, it is very difficult. But the reward for that, you are fighting the Khawarij. Who is the Khawarij? Is our rulers, the people who kill Muslims and leave alone Kafirs, the people who go out of the Sharia, the people who are controlling us and trying to make us a booty for the West and for the East. Those are the Khawarij, which Rasulullah said that the best murderer by their hands, the best shaheed is the one who's killed by their hands. The best ajr you do by fighting them. And the other hadith, Rasulullah, as we said, he said, you got, if you know what reward has been written on the tongue of Muhammad for fighting these people, you would probably don't do anything else in Islam. It's a very big, large reward. A very big, large rule. If I tell you that half an hour fighting these people or even teasing these people is better than hundreds of years of worship. If just the enemies of Islam, the normal enemies of Islam, when one Sahabi asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, let me stay here in a very nice area and worship Allah and pray. Then Rasulullah said, don't do that, because the place for you in the rows, in the battle of fight, the place for you, the one you spend there, 1 hour is better than 70 years of worship. Because why? Because don't be greedy, you want worship alone. What about earth? All the earth want worship. The ground, your floor, you know, when you sit down, when you do sujood, and when you die, that place which you do sujood, it cries for you. And the place where your action goes into the sky also cries for you. It's according to the Quran and according to the Hadith. So how many people now have left Islam because of the authority of kufr? Yes, we work for da'wah, we ask people, but people have questions in their eyes. But if I follow you, I'll be killed. And if I follow you, I will be mocked at. And if I wear your clothes and I wear your hat and I wear your turbans. But if we are in authority, everybody wants to wear our clothes, everybody wants to learn our language, everybody wants to follow us, everybody wants to fight, everybody wants to take Islam out. Take Islam. It needs a sacrifice. So the beginning of the people, you are the people who are gonna try, who make the track. You make the track for the Muslims. Before the train goes 300 kilometers an hour, before the train goes 300 kilometers an hour, it's full of people and people are relaxing. And these trains of Islam, we want to build these trains of Islam like the Sahaba built it. The Sahaba built the train, the tracks, which over them was the trains and the carriages, which is full of people relaxed. They enter Islam easy, they live easy Islam, they enjoy and they make benefit out of Islam. And over the years, here come the intruders and here come the enemies of Islam. They loosen the tracks, they took the wooden from the track, they displaced the track, and there is no more people coming to Islam. Everybody comes to Islam, brrr, he falls down. Everybody comes to Islam, he falls down. So it needs work. We have left the track of Islam so long, unattended, unmaintained, until the track is now people going out of Islam, because it's a dangerous track. Why should I take a journey and I'm going to fall off in the middle or in the end? So they take the
they take the train of kufr. They come to Europe to learn instead of learning in Muslim land. We come to Europe to live because the signs say here that leave Islam, you'll be safe. Or have some Islam, not all Islam, you will have some difficulties, but not all difficulties. And this is what most of people do. I'll take some of Islam and I leave some of Islam because I want to be a Muslim, but I don't want to be hurt. That is not the answer. I will take Islam, I will be hurt, but I will not be losing and I will not be tricking myself. I will live as a Muslim and I will die as a Muslim. And there is nothing here. If the Kafirs were sacrificing for the football, if they sacrifice for the race and color, if they sacrifice for homosexuality, if they are willing to go and fight and kill and organize and everything because of their dirty minds, aren't we doing this for Islam? And they know once they close their eyes, they are the owners of the fire hell. And we know once we close our eyes, we're going to be with the Hur al-Ain and the Jannah. So if we do believe, is it the action for a belief? So I said, we must have respectable leaders. And no leader is respectable when all brothers and sisters are humiliated in prison just because they say, La ilaha illallah, this is haram. How come you want us to live inside the haram? Come, put in prison, oppress them, take their money, don't play with the children, don't support them. Now in Egypt, if you know some poor families in Egypt and their husbands are in prison, if you send some money, you will get 15 years in prison. And the woman will be beaten up to death. And they hang them up, they hang our women, our sisters, the veiled sisters. If they don't rape them, they hang them. And they play domino. While one have a sister on this side, and the other sister on the other side, and the Kafirs of our countries, they play domino. And they use their private parts as ashtrays. And we are sitting here. And Allah said, this is not on. If one woman is arrested, if one woman is in the hand of unsafe people, the whole ummah must relieve her. Al-Hajjaj, who was cursed by many scholars, he killed many Sahaba. When he was here that Muslim women were abused in India, he have sent a large army to free them. Wallahi, if Al-Hajjaj was right now, although he was cursed, wallahi, if Al-Hajjaj was now, wallahi, I would give him bay'ah and I would follow him. Although he was a minister of a wrongdoer, wallahi, I will be the first one. Because there's nobody else in power and nobody else can fight and nobody else wants to fight. He is a fasik, but he's not a kafir. Al-Hajjaj is a fasik. He's not a kafir. He was applying the Sharia. Yes, he killed many, but he was killing people for his throne, not was killing people because of Islam. He was not killing people because they're Muslims. He was killing people for the throne of Marwan ibn al-Hakam and the rest of the family, of the Amawi families. But now we don't. We have people are killed, not because they are Ali and Hassan, and because they are Muslims. Because they want to apply the Sharia. Because they don't want to associate with kufr. And what more kufr can be than that?
Most people are calling the selfies Kharijis because they're back to the level. Should they call the selfies Kharijis?
No. Many of the Salafi brothers nowadays are being tricked and they have been and they are God-fearing brothers and sisters, and many people are using their God-fearing thing to tell them, if you go out of the Hakim, you will be Khawarij. So because of this, they are not, they mind in their own business, say, we don't want to interfere in this. And they tell them, don't interfere in politics. Although the scholars are interfering in politics, all these fatwas is politics. What more politics say that Jews and Christians can allow to stay there? What more politics to say that nobody should fight these people forever? What more politics say? So they are telling them, let us talk on their behalf and you will be safe. So they are tricked. And although some of them are criminals, but we cannot generalize. And unfortunately, what we can say like Imam Ali said, that they are our brothers and they are wrongdoing us. And they are just shooting us with these titles. They call us Khawarij, and they are defending the rulers where they should not be doing. They are doing haram thing by doing this thing. But a lot of them, they're doing that haram thing because of the scholars. They said it's okay. And what we advise them is to study more and link the history together. Don't be very narrow. Don't look through the needle of the eye only. Just
you know, increase your sight a little bit and start looking, you know, ask yourself a question: would Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, would he, was he a Khawarij? Or if Al Saud is Khawarij, and if they've done so against the legitimate Khilafah, now how come? And what they have gone against the Khilafah was nothing, none of the mistakes of the Khilafah, because the Khalifa, the Uthman Khalifa, he did not change the Sharia. He did not ask the people to worship the graves. It was area far from him. But what we are fighting now is their rulers changing the Sharia. Their rulers are putting us in trouble. Their rulers are kicking us from our own countries, and they are cuddling the kafirs in their countries, in the country of Islam. So who's the Khawarij, what we are saying? I'm just asking, please, try to be fair. Sometimes we give harsh comments to them, just from the point of view to wake them up. But to say that they are Khawarij, or they are Murji'a, or they are this, I don't think it's fair. And I think that we leave that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to judge between us and them. And we just have to advise them. But I'm saying that knowledge behind closed doors is dangerous. We must be open. They've got nothing to hide. It's either we learn something we did not know, or either we deliver something we knew and others did not know. I have in my mosque some of the Salafi brothers, they come and they said, could you give us a room for teaching? I say, no. Teach here like everybody else, because if you say a wrong hadith, somebody could answer you. The Tablighi brothers, they teach in here in the open, we are teaching here in the open, and the mosque can have everybody. In the time of the guided scholars, it was under every pillar there used to be a sheikh. The mosque would have 20 pillars and have 20 sheikhs. Everyone have his students and everybody learn. What harms you? And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz said, he said, وَتَحَلَّقُوا and make circles and talk about knowledge. فَإِنَّ الْعِلْمَ لَا يَهْلَكَ حَتَّى يَكُونَ سِرَّ. Knowledge will never be destroyed except when it becomes secret. When knowledge becomes secret and shh, don't listen to this one, don't listen to that one, don't do this, don't do that, don't come, don't attend to this one. When knowledge becomes secret, it becomes dangerous. And this is why when there was so many torturing and so many people in the time of Jesus, after Jesus alayhi salam, everybody went to the cave, closed doors, they came back after 10 years with 2,000 Bibles. Because knowledge in closed doors, it develops. It develops. First time you're going to call your brothers Khawarij, and then you're going to call the other people this, and you're going to call people and make tapes and don't, this is only for you. Islam is not like that. This is nothing to do with Islam. And this is what we say now, that many people are now going into the bid'ah of sheikhism, that they love and hate for the sheikh. They want to touch. If the sheikh cannot touch him, regardless, even if the sheikh contradicts himself, he's a sheikh. They worship him. They don't realize. But they do, as Rasulullah said, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله, that they have taken their priests and their rabbis, gods beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then one Christian, he said, oh Rasulullah, they never used to worship them. Then he said, didn't they make halal haram for them, and haram halal for them, and they obeyed them? He said, yes. He said, this is their worship. Now we are asking, the scholars of the Gulf have made enjoying the good and forbid the evil haram for us to stand outside a bank and say, Allahumma, this is haram. Don't say this is haram. To go in the front of and use agent when you see naked pictures next to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or in the peninsula, they say, Allahumma, this haram, said, you're a troublemaker. To see that dirty king wearing a cross, you say, Allahumma, this is haram, said, you're a Khawarij. In the other side, they don't enjoin the good and forbid the evil themselves. In the other side, they put the haram things. They have said, don't fight these people forever. A fatwa which have never been issued. Even the Christians, if you tell them make a fatwa for jihad, which you will be benefit, wallahi, they will not make this fatwa. They will say, if we make it, the people will not accept it from us. At least let's make it for 100 years. At least let's make it for 100 years, and then we can make another one. But that clear, naked obscenity, when their kind of fatwa said no jihad against these people forever. And then you see the barrels of the tanks and the barrels of the Kalashnikovs, and instead of were pointing towards Jews, is now all pointing towards mosques. And when the sheikh inside says something about Islam, then you see the police car going, wow, wow. I mean, keep your voice down or we'll deal with you. What's happening in Egypt? Any more questions, brother? Let's start from the right. Yeah?
That's why it's at the moment. He said that in Islamic State.
Afghanistan at the moment. It is the nearest to the Islamic State, and they need our support, of course. Because my dear brother, don't forget that we are fighting to have an Islamic State after hundreds of years of enemies of Islam cooperating against us, and we've been sleeping and snoring. And if somebody sleeps and snores for quite some time, when he wakes up, he's not going to see everything in the right place. He's going to see a little bit dizzily, and he will walk and he will hit the bed, and then he will hit this and he will hit that. He will do some mistakes, and then when it comes to another, after 1 hour, when he brush his teeth and he look properly and he have wudu and he prays, then things become easy. Then he goes down, then he is normal in his midday or after 1 hour. And this is what's happening. Afghanistan have suffered a lot, and but alhamdulillah, although they have been fighting against each other, but now it is only 1 or 2 years until when they have just one emir or one source. So we have to give them a chance. And also we have to learn something else. Don't think that when you start working for Islam that you're going to see Umar ibn Khattab straight away. You're going to have a lot of mistakes seen, but some mistakes are tolerable and some are not. And these people try to apply the Sharia. Yes, they do some a little bit mistakes here and there, but subhanallah, what else are we dreaming about? What we're hoping that they open their land for Hijrah, and many brothers can go there and help. And wallahi, if we go there and get killed, I know there is many munafiqeen there who can kill the foreigners and take their money as booties, but the country is doing its best. And we have been to be killed, tricked by Islam, is better to stay in the land of Kufr. We must go there and give them support and work. They need dawah. Even the people now who call themselves Taliban, many of them are not Taliban. Many of them are just the residuals of the other groups. When their leaders fled, they stay there and they make themselves Taliban. So some people are giving them a bad name. They are not from amongst them. So we have to be tolerable with them, and we need to be more understanding. And we don't just kick every seed in our path. And when the Taliban is a small seed, it needs attention, it needs help, and it needs, it needs that we look after it and we water it reasonably. We don't drown it, so we have to consult ourselves how also we look after it, and also we don't starve it, yeah? And when they do mistake, you have been ordered, when somebody does a mistake, enjoin the good and forbid the evil. If he kills you, you are a martyr. That is what you have to do. There is no other choice. Somebody raised the banner of Islam, he helps Islam, help him. If he does a mistake, then do your best, enjoin the good and forbid the evil between you and him. And then, as long as he doesn't do a plain kufr. If he does a plain kufr, then it's not between you and him anymore. Yeah? If somebody makes a plain sin, then you advise him, as the Sahaba said, why you do this to Umar ibn Khattab? If he does something which is, hidden, then you advise him hidden. If he does something which is explicit, then you have to do it. If it concerns everybody, you have to say it. And what the Taliban doing, I don't think it does deserve that we denounce them. They are, especially if they are the only people now trying to apply Islam on earth. And I think we have to be tolerable to them and help them. Jazakallah khair. From the right, anybody question? Then we'll go back again. Anybody? Abu Hamza, let me have. Any question?
Well, I'll fire one more at you. And, this one, right, it's a leaflet about what they're saying is two particle brothers. One claims that they're Khajis, the other one says they're Khajis, right? Two parties fight each other. What they say, they don't follow the Quran and these, they follow the sheikhs, like what you said about sheikhs. Like shorting the beard, right?
What, and only with this issue or on every issue?
No, on different issues what the sheikhs give them. They said they leave the Quran and Hadith and they follow the sheikh's teachings.
Right.
So there's a leaflet about shaving the beard, right? Bukhari Sheikh says, grow it long and trim the moustache, other Hadiths as well.
Mm-hmm.
What should the jihadist brothers do in this case? Because a lot of jihadist brothers have small beard, they trim it.
Mm-hmm.
Like Safi brothers, they call them Khajis because they trim the beards of
No.
So what should the Jihadi brothers do in that case? When there's gone these clear cuts saying that there should be Bukhari Shri, Muslim Shri, Ismail Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi.
Yeah, about the beard. It's nothing to do with jihadis. It's wrong to say these people are Salafis or this jihad. If they choose that for themselves, we'd rather to be called Muslims. Because it's haram, as we explained in the tapes called Salafism, Sheikhism, to have these titles. Because the people say, when you start somebody say, oh, the jihadis have said this, that could be a kufr, because that means you don't believe in jihad. Yeah? No. No. If they contradict what they say, then it'd be a different matter. With regard to the differences, we have to understand something. There is a differences which we should make these differences. If the differences with regard to the belief, and somebody differentiate with us, say for example somebody is saying saying something else about Jesus, says Jesus was not killed, for example, or was not Jesus he was killed, or he was crucified, denying the Quran, it becomes something to do with the belief. If somebody said the Jews are Muslim, are going to paradise, even the Jews are now our time now, they will say no. This is something which we have to have differences in that, and this is what's called the recommended differences, yeah. And there is the unrecommended differences, which is the haram differences, which from the point of fiqh, anything which is not regarding to the basics of iman, like the belief in Allah, the belief in His names and attributes, the belief of the angels, the belief of the hereafter, the belief of the belief of the books, and the belief of the divine destiny, then anything else which is not with regard to the point of fiqh, then we cannot do differences, because this is haram. The first difference, we allow even to spill our blood into it, like ruling by other than Allah. This is from the iman, from the corners of iman. Allah said, you don't believe, if you don't rule by, you fail to rule by Allah, by Allah's religion, you are a kafir. Allah said, if you legislate in Surah Ash-Shura, I'm going for jihad now, and if I go with my beard, you're going to kill me. I will shave my beard. Yeah? These are differences of ijtihad, and we cannot false this, we cannot make differences for that. We said, may Allah guide you, Allah knows your intention, but you don't have a beard, you don't have a beard, then you don't pray imam. Then, although you have a plan for yourself, because we should have our imam, he have his beard, yeah? And we should have our imam have his also Islamic clothes. Then even if you have a plan in your mind, or if you have a fatwa for your mind, then that is for you, not for the whole ummah. But we don't make enmity because of that. His brother's praying, he putting his hand in the chest, or putting his hand in... All these are sunnah. These are sunnah. The only time, even raising your hand in the first prayer, by the first takbir, Allahu Akbar, it's also sunnah. If you say Allahu Akbar without raising your hand, still your prayer is valid. What about the other raising your hand in the middle of the prayer? We're going to leave the Jews and Christians taking our land, and we're talking about raising the hand or saying Ameen. These are all sunnahs. There is no differences between the four big imams with regard to whatever is wajib, or whatever, as it's called, the Hanafi said, is fard. So this is unrecommended differences. It becomes to haram. And we live in the recommended differences, and we are talking about the unrecommended differences. We are now making difference, shall we fight Jews and Christians or not? This is something which we should not be disputing about. Shall we try to apply the Sharia now or not? This is something we should not talk about. This is something from the main belief. What we should not talk about is saying Ameen, putting his hand like this, putting this, wearing a turban, not wearing a turban, wearing a jarabiyah or wearing a qamis. This is something which is only silly people talk about it, and unknowledgeable people talk about it. And this has not been raised in the time of the Sahaba or Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because they were concentrating about the corners of the belief. So whatever these brothers are saying, no way something which is not in the middle of the belief, or not on the basics of the belief, that we call somebody his khawarij because of it, or his fasiq because of it. No. The Hanafis, they believe that unmarried, the previously married woman, for example, she can have married without wali. Although this hadith said that no nikah without a wali. They said, oh, this is for the virgin. But this is not for the virgin, this is for everyone. But many places when the judge, for example, he judged in this case according to his mazhab, it has never been narrated that when another judge come after him to take the work, that he said, oh, bring me the other judge's thing and I will correct him. It never been happened like that. That means he will divorce many women, that means he will... No. This is what Allah allows. When everybody rules according to his mazhab, as long as he does his ijtihad, then okay. And don't expect people to leave their mazhab. And when somebody comes and says, oh, this hadith is in Bukhari, this hadith is in Muslim, so they say, okay, you are Hanafi, you follow Abu Hanifa, what about this hadith in Bukhari? What about this hadith in Muslim? Allahu Akbar. And then if you do this, if he follows you, he will be in trouble, because maybe you are not knowledgeable enough, maybe there's other hadith as well. What he should do from what you give him is to become interested about the matter and to search and learn, because for him, if he follows anybody, then he will end up without a mazhab, without knowledge, without anything. And what I'm not recommending here, mazhabism, but what I'm saying is mazhabism is better than ignorism. It is better than ignorism. I don't know, for example, a situation about a matter, and only have and I'm not Hanafi or I'm not Hanbali, I'm trying to follow the evidence. But the room where I am in now, it doesn't have books to give me the evidence, and I only have a book of Imam Abu Hanifa, for example, here. Then what shall I do? I follow my own mind, or shall I follow Abu Hanifa? I follow Abu Hanifa, rahmahullah, until I find other things. When I see this, some dispute, then I try to see the evidence. When I have no evidence, or when I have no satisfactory evidence, I should follow a proper imam. You understand what I'm saying? And if somebody follows his imam and somebody else follows his imam, for as long as it's not from the believing point of view, from the corner of the belief, then we will be very silly, devilish, if we magnify. And unfortunately, people who now are trying to follow the Salafi's way, they have turned against the Hanafi brothers, as if the Hanafi brothers have become Allahu Akbar. What is that? If you're not allowed to fight Jews, if you don't want to fight Jews and Christians, you're going to go fight the Hanafi's brothers, Allah. And who's Imam Abu Hanifa? He's the teacher of all scholars, Allahu Akbar. Yes, we can be a teacher, and some students become more brilliant than you, but it is because of they have learned and they have read some more books, but you are the main scholar and the main scholars. And nobody, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, he said very nice things about Abu Hanifa. All the Imam said, even the Imam said, كُلِّ الْعُلَمَاءِ كُلَّ إِمَّا عِيَالْ Abu Hanifa. They are the children of Abu Hanifa. So comes here somebody, 17 years old, and he comes and says, Abu Hanifa this and Abu Hanifa. Allahu Akbar, what is that? And most of the scholars, they use the way Abu Hanifa deals with evidence to deduct the evidence. He had the best way to deduct the evidence, but he had short hadith. He did not have enough hadith of his time. But applying the methodology of Abu Hanifa for the amount of hadith we have, it gives you the right way. And this is what we are trying to say. Differences in opinion between brothers, if it's not from the core of Iman, it's from the shaitan, and it's going to make nothing but making the shaitan happy with us. And alhamdulillah, now many youth are coming for non-madhabism. The kafirs, before, they used to invest in mazhabism. They used to make people fighting with us because of mazhab. So the youth are now coming, trying to follow the evidence. So don't spoil it. It doesn't mean that you want to follow the evidence that you denounce people, that you denounce the imams of mazhab, or you denounce some other scholar. So be fair. Especially most of these people, they don't even say a word to their scholars when they go up and down their fatwas. At least we know Imam Abu Hanifa is a mujahid imam, and we know the other imams are mujahid imams. So let us deal with people for what they are, and we see the silly people from the real concerned people about Islam. People talk about the nitty-gritties, and they talk about the nuts and bolts, and if they are the main structures, these people are the enemies of Islam, whether they like it or not. May Allah give us all guidance. I've been talking to you very long. Jazakumullah khairan. Inshallah, we'll see you some other time. Thank you for your patience. Subhanakallahumma hamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.